The committee will come to order. The chairman notes the presence of a quorum, which under Committee Rule 3E is two members, and we've greatly exceeded that. The Committee on Natural Resources is meeting today to hear testimony on an oversight hearing on the future of U.S. oil and natural gas development on federal lands and waters. Under Committee Rule 4F, opening statements are limited to the chairman and the ranking member of the committee. However, I ask unanimous consent that any members that wish to have an opening statement inserted in the record do so by the close of business today and without objection, so ordered. I'll now recognize myself for 5 minutes for my opening statement. I appreciate very much, Mr. Secretary, your being here to talk about the future of oil and natural gas production on federal lands and federal waters. As this committee has regularly pointed out, U.S. energy production is vital to creating jobs, strengthening our national security, and generating new federal revenue. That's why it's important to not only remove government hurdles that stand in the way of increased energy production, but to explore new opportunities and new areas for energy production. There are two specific topics that I hope to focus on today: the Interior Department's potential regulation of hydraulic fracturing on federal lands, and the administration's new draft five-year offshore leasing plan that was unveiled last week. For the record, I asked the Secretary to testify before our committee prior to the Interior Department issuing any new regulations or requirements regarding fracturing, and I'm very pleased again that the Secretary is here at my request. And I understand, according at least to news reports, that those new regulations and requirements will come out at any time, and we'll pursue that later. It's the responsibility of this committee to carefully examine this issue and to ensure that any action taken by the administration is within the law and takes into consideration the impacts on jobs, local communities, states, the revenue, and of course our economy. Hydraulic fracturing is necessary to extract natural gas and oil from unconventional shale resources. It has been effectively regulated by states for over 60 years, and the process today is responsible for 30% of our domestic oil and natural gas production. Given that President Obama has identified natural gas usage as an area in which he wants to seek bipartisan cooperation, it's concerning that the potential onerous regulations could drastically curtail that cooperation and impede its development in the usage. But that's why we're having this hearing today, to explore that. Another proposal we will closely examine is the administration's draft five-year leasing plan for the OCS. Let me start by reminding everybody that in 2008, both Congress and President lifted a decades-long ban on new offshore drilling. This created new opportunities off the Atlantic and Pacific coasts for energy production, for job creation, and, of course, for new revenues to the federal government. Unfortunately, these opportunities have been missed, I believe, by this administration. They have ignored the bipartisan will of both Congress and the American people to allow for new drilling off our coasts. The administration's draft plan only allows lease sales to occur in areas that were previously open, and it indefinitely delays the Virginia lease sale scheduled to take place next year, and I'm sure we'll hear about that in the hearing. With this, the President has effectively put the moratorium back in place that left in 2008. It should be noted also that this plan is approximately 2 years late. The plan was supposed to be for the 2010-2015 time frame, with new lease sales starting in 2011. The administration's plan for 6 months, and they punted the plan for 6 months and eventually ended up delaying it for a couple years. Despite this two-year delay, there are no new areas offered in the draft plan. The administration took an extra 2 years to then offer less than what was originally proposed. In contrast, the House has passed three bipartisan bills that will create over a million new jobs by providing access to our own U.S. energy and opening up new offshore areas for drilling that contain the most oil and natural gas resources. We will likely hear today that the U.S. oil and natural gas production is at an all-time high. Yet, that is true only because of the actions and policies of past administrations, both Republican and Democrat administrations. that allowed for the leasing and production of our energy resources on public lands. And, of course, we cannot ignore the significant oil boom on private and state lands in North Dakota. We will not be able to continue to meet our country's energy and economic needs if restrictive policies are imposed that lock up our energy resources and keep us at the mercy of foreign sources with our energy needs. And once again, that is one of the reasons that we want to explore for this hearing, is to look at what we can do on our public lands. And with that, I yield back my time and recognize the gentleman from Massachusetts, Mr. Markey.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, very much. Mr. Secretary, it's a pleasure to welcome you back to the Natural Resources Committee. Last week, you released a five-year plan for domestic offshore oil and gas drilling, and I was very pleased that the plan protects the East Coast, and especially New England, from offshore drilling for at least the next 5 years. The BP oil spill in the Gulf has many on the East Coast renewing their opposition to drilling. However, I am concerned that the plan does include new lease sales off of Alaska, even though the oil industry has not effectively proven that they can respond to a spill in the icy, harsh conditions offshore in the Arctic. As one example of the threats faced in Alaskan waters, just last weekend, much of Alaska was thrashed with a superstorm that produced 40-foot waves and 100-mile-per-hour winds. Now, while the administration has delayed those Arctic lease sales until 2015, I will continue to monitor the progress the industry makes in developing its response capabilities and ensure that the Interior Department is holding the industry to the highest safety standards in this sensitive area. But all in all, this new five-year plan means that more than 75% of all offshore oil and gas resources in the United States will be made available to oil and gas companies. Yet the Republican majority continues to claim that the administration is locking up our resources. In reality, domestic oil production is at its highest level in nearly a decade. Offshore oil production is higher than it was during the final years of the Bush administration, and natural gas production is at an all-time high. The great irony is that the Republican majority that is blocking access to the real resources American people need right now, additional revenue to reduce our budget deficit. It is the Republican majority that is protecting the billions of dollars we could retrieve from making oil and gas companies pay their fair share for drilling on our public lands. It is the Republican majority that has opposed Democratic efforts to close free drilling loopholes and unnecessary tax breaks. And it is the Republican majority that has consistently voted against reforming the 1872 mining law to require mining companies to pay a royalty to mine for gold and uranium or other minerals on the public lands of the American people. By protecting oil companies and preventing the government from collecting the revenue it is rightfully owed for the exploitation of our public resources, the Republicans are making our debt negotiations look a lot worse than the NBA lockout. Later this week, the Energy and Minerals Subcommittee will hold a hearing on several Republican bills that would give away more public lands, including the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge, to pay for a transportation bill. Those bills won't even come close to paying for the maintenance of our roads and our bridges, but they will grease the skids for the oil companies to continue making record profits. This scheme is both short on funds and it is a bridge too far. But that is not stopping them from trying to use funding for our transportation projects as an excuse to railroad giveaways to those interests in Congress. Enough is enough. Rather than balancing our budget on the backs of seniors and millions of Americans who are struggling, we should be ensuring that oil companies are paying their fair share. And that is why I am introducing legislation today that will end the free ride for oil and gas and mining companies on public land. The legislation would reduce the deficit by nearly $19 billion over the next 10 years just by ending taxpayer-funded giveaways for those companies. Rather than complaining about a five-year drilling plan that opens up more areas than oil companies could ever drill in that time, we believe that the majority should join with the Democrats in creating the 10-year plan we need to reduce the deficit and pay down our debt. I look forward to hearing from you, Mr. Secretary, and I yield back the balance of my time.
I thank the gentleman for his opening statement, and once again, I want to thank very much Secretary of Interior Salazar for being here. You know the rules. We talked a little bit, and you want to divide your time with your opening statement, and we certainly want to do that. So, Mr. Secretary, I'll recognize you for your opening statement, and for Mr. Abbey and Mr. Boudreau. Recognized.
Thank you very much, Chairman Hastings and Ranking Member Markey and members of this committee. I am honored to appear before you today to engage in a dialogue about the nation's energy future. I am joined here at the table by Bob Abbey, who is the Director of the Bureau of Land Management, which oversees 700 million mineral acres and about 250 million surface acres, and by Bobby Boudreau, who is the Director of the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management, who oversees America's oceans and energy production in America's oceans. The President's plan with respect to energy has been in place for some time since the beginning of our administration, and we have a simple goal, as he has often articulated, and that is to secure the energy future of the United States of America. His goal and our goal in the administration is to power the U.S. economy and to reduce our dependence on foreign oil. The policy underpinnings of our goal are policy underpinnings which have been debated for a long time. But frankly, the goals have eluded the American country, the American nation, for a long time to come. Those policy underpinnings are the economic security of this country, the national security of the United States, and the environmental security of this nation. The question then, how is it that we get there, and what is it that we are trying to do to get us to achieve those goals and those policy imperatives? We believe in a broad energy portfolio. It's a broad energy portfolio that does include oil and gas production. It includes alternative energy such as renewable energy, solar, wind, geothermal. It also includes a new chapter on nuclear energy. We also believe that we cannot just produce our way to energy independence in our country, but we also have to use less, and as a consequence of that, the fuel efficiency programs that we have put into place are delivering record-breaking efficiency programs with respect to transportation fuels. Now, oil and gas has been a key part of the Obama administration from the beginning. We are walking the talk, and the statistics prove it. We have produced in 2010 the highest production since 2003 on oil on public lands. The Outer Continental Shelf has increased in production one-third from 2008 until 2010. And onshore oil, we have seen a 5% increase on public lands over the last 2 years. The future production on public lands is something which we support. We have moved forward with onshore leasing across the country. In 2010, 33 lease sales and 3.2 million acres. 2011, 32 lease sales. 2012, 33 are scheduled as well. On the offshore, we've offered 37 million acres. We have three more lease areas that we will be putting on the market under the current plan between now and the spring. And then the 2012 to 2017 plan has 15 lease sales that are also in that plan. The results are that we are producing more and we are using less. And we have gotten to the point where, for the first time in recent history, we are importing less than 50% of our oil from foreign countries. Tommy Boudreau will speak to the offshore OCS plan for just a couple of minutes, and Bob Abbey will speak to natural gas and fracking for just a couple of minutes. But I want to make just a comment on the offshore OCS. The plan that we put forward last year or last week, in my view, is a plan that focuses on the known reserves and the known resources where we have the infrastructure to produce oil and gas in America's oceans, and it also looks to frontier areas, including the frontier areas in Alaska. On the natural gas effort, it is, as you said, Chairman Hastings, an area where there can be bipartisan work because our policy goal is to support natural gas usage here in this country. But we also, I have the view that the issue of fracking is the Achilles heel for our natural gas industry unless we can move forward with a program that does disclose the chemicals that are being injected into the underground. But we are developing a rule and are taking input from lots of different places to make sure that it is a rule that does not push back on the bright future for natural gas. And with that, what I'd like to do is to turn it to Director Abbey for a few comments on what we've been doing on fracking.
Director Abbey, go ahead.
Well, thank you, Chairman Hastings. Thank you, Secretary Salazar, and members of the committee. I'm proud of the work that the Department of Interior is doing to diversify our nation's energy portfolio by making greater use of renewable energy sources from our public lands. Solar, wind, hydropower, geothermal will one day be major sources for energy in this nation, and we're laying the foundation now for that to occur. However, we're not naive, and for the foreseeable future, our nation will be dependent on oil, natural gas, and coal. Given this reality, the Department of Interior has undertaken much-needed reforms in our own minerals program that makes available appropriate public lands for mineral development while providing greater certainty to industry that the lands being made available for leasing can be developed and in a more timely manner. Our reforms have already been successful in reducing conflict, litigation, and protests that had adversely affected the development of oil and gas from public lands for years. Today, we have a more orderly process for leasing and developing oil and gas. Parcels that are being leased today are the parcels that have the greatest chance of being developed the quickest. And while oil and natural gas will be a primary component of our nation's energy portfolio for years to come, the increased use of hydraulic fracturing on both public and private lands has understandably generated concerns among the public about possible impacts to water quality and availability. This was the primary concern that we heard from local government officials and the public at community forums that we hosted last spring in North Dakota, Colorado, and Arkansas. Over 90% of all the wells that are being drilled on public lands today are using this technology. It's therefore important that we remain diligent in confirming the integrity of the wellbore prior to the hydraulic fracturing operation, as well as monitoring the wellbore during the process to ensure that underground water resources remain isolated and protected. The Department of Interior, as Secretary Salazar alluded to, is committed to ensuring that development activities occurring on the public lands are being conducted in a safe and responsible manner that protects human health and safety while bringing in a fair return to the American taxpayer for the development of their mineral assets.
And Director Boudreau.
Thank you, Secretary Salazar. Chairman Hastings, Ranking Member Markey, and members of the committee, I thank you for the opportunity to appear before this committee today to discuss our proposed Outer Continental Shelf oil and gas leasing program for 2012 to 2017. This is my first appearance before the committee, and so I'll start by introducing myself and my new agency. I am the director of the Bureau of Offshore Energy Management, BOEM, which is responsible for managing the environmentally sound development of conventional and renewable offshore energy and ensuring that the American public receives fair value for the use of our shared resources. In June 2010, while the response to the Deepwater Horizon spill was ongoing, I left my law practice to join the Interior Department. For the past 17 months, I've worked with Secretary Salazar and Director Bromwich to design and implement our aggressive and sweeping reform agenda, which has made offshore oil and gas development safer and our oversight of industry more effective. I grew up in Alaska, where my father worked on the North Slope for an oil and gas exploration company. I was raised to enjoy and appreciate the outdoors, hiking, hunting, and fishing in our last frontier, and was deeply saddened by the Exxon Valdez oil spill. As an Alaskan, I know firsthand both the critical role energy development plays in our economy, as well as the imperative that this activity be conducted safely and with appropriate protections for the environment. This same balance is the core mission of and responsibility of my agency and is fundamental to the proposed 2012 to 2017 offshore leasing program that we published last week. Under this five-year plan, we have scheduled 12 lease sales in the Gulf of Mexico, where the oil and gas resources are abundant and well understood, and the infrastructure to support responsible development is mature. The first of these sales under the new program is scheduled for next fall. We also have scheduled 3 potential lease sales in the Alaskan OCS, including one each in the Beaufort Sea and Chukchi Sea planning areas. We have designed the program so that these sales will be deliberately tailored to the unique Arctic environment, where there is significant resource potential, but also where careful consideration must be given to protecting those sensitive ecosystems and to respecting Native Alaskans' cultural and subsistence reliance on the ocean. We are embarking on a comprehensive outreach campaign to engage with the public on the proposed five-year program. In December, we will hold 13 public hearings in Gulf states, Alaska, and here in Washington, D.C. I will personally attend the hearings in New Orleans, Washington, and several Alaskan villages so that I will hear firsthand the comments and concerns of members of the communities most directly involved with and connected to offshore oil and gas leasing. Offshore energy is and will continue to be a critical component of the United States' domestic energy strategy. I join the Secretary in expressing appreciation for your attention to the five-year program and the opportunity to discuss it with you today.
Thank you very much, all three of you, for your opening statements. We'll begin the questioning, and I recognize myself for 5 minutes. Mr. Secretary, there has been obviously a lot of discussion on economic recovery. We have tried the idea of stimulating the economy. I think the proof is in the pudding that that simply hasn't worked. There needs to be a new way to do it. The approach that we look at least from my perspective, and I think a lot of members on, probably most members on my side of the aisle, is an effort to jumpstart the economy. And one way to jumpstart the economy is to recognize how important energy is to our economy. Energy jobs are good-paying jobs, as you well know, and there's also a national security aspect to having American-made energy. The reason I say that with this in context of what we're talking about today, and if you put up the first slide I have, the first slide here shows the United States. Can you put that slide up on the screen? There it is. After 2008, as you recall, for decades there was a presidential and a congressional moratoria on drilling on the OCS. Both those moratoria went away at the start of this administration. So these were the opportunities that I alluded to in my opening statement for production, and is essentially everything, as you can see there in the green. The Eastern Gulf, of course, was closed off until I think 2012 or 2021, whatever that figure is. That was the only one. Everything else was an opportunity. Your draft plan, if you put up the second slide now, your draft plan essentially takes away all of the outer continental shelf on the Atlantic and part of what was potentially open in Alaska, and it puts restrictions, more restrictions, while it is open in Chukchi and Beaufort. And my question to you, in your opening statement, you said that natural gas, the president has said that natural gas is a broad part of our broad energy portfolio. So when you contrast the two together, if you put up the third slide, you can see them side by side. I in all honesty, Mr. Secretary, think that the plan compared to where the opportunities were going into this administration are, you know, maybe a kind word is underwhelming. And I just want your comments on that.
Thank you very much, Chairman Hastings. Let me make 2 points on this. The first is that I think it's important for this committee and the Congress and the United States to not have amnesia about the Deepwater Horizon and the Macondo Well. It was, in fact, a national crisis that gripped the United States Congress, the President's leadership and the involvement of the administration and industry that basically brought the runaway well under control. But what it showed was that there were significant issues that raised the conclusion, which I hope you agree with, that the oil and gas industry simply was not prepared to deal with that kind of a blowout. And so we've taken major steps with a major overhaul of the Department of Interior's former MMS agency to make sure that we have the appropriate oversight. And we will work closely with industry to develop the containment strategies and the prevention strategies to be able to move forward to stand up production in the Gulf of Mexico once again. So as we look at the maps that you have put up there, Congressman Chairman Hastings, we have tried to move forward in a way that is thoughtful given the lessons that have been learned from the Macondo well. And so the targeting of the Gulf of Mexico, which is a place where we have the best known available information and the best infrastructure, is the best place to go for oil and gas development. And that's why 12 lease sales have been scheduled there. In Alaska and in the Arctic, there are places which we don't believe that we ought to drill. For example, Bristol Bay is a place that we have put off limits for 5 years because of the fact that it is the kind of place that we believe should not move forward right now with oil and gas production. On the other hand, when you look at the Beaufort and the Chukchi Sea, it's a place where we need to develop additional information, and so we are doing that and doing it in a thoughtful way.
All right, thank you. And I have one other question, and it deals with the organic legislation that you and I have talked about in the reorganization. As you know, on Friday, or tomorrow, we will be marking up that that regulation. And since you are here today, albeit on different issues, how do you feel about the importance of codifying or structuring that law as we have talked about, real briefly?
Chairman Hastings, long before the Deepwater Horizon, I sat in the same table and I suggested to this committee that organic legislation was needed for the then MMS. I continue to believe that to be the case today.
Good. Thank you very much, Mr. Secretary. Thank you for your response. Gentleman from Massachusetts, Mr. Markey.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, very much. Over the past 10 years, leasing of the last 10 leases in the Gulf of Mexico dating back to August of 2005, the Interior Department has offered more than 39,000 tracts to oil companies to drill. Of these, just 36,000 tracts received any bids from oil companies. That means that oil companies are not even bidding on 90% of the public lands offshore being offered to them. And so, Mr. Secretary, if they're not drilling, if they're not bidding for those leases, what's going on out there? Why? You've identified those as areas that could have oil under them, and yet for 90% of those areas, there's no bids at all from the oil industry.
The fact is that there are vast acreage in the offshore that are already under lease, and there is vast acreage onshore as well that is under lease, but those places are not yet being developed. And so one of the things that we've done is to put in place incentives with respect to the new five-year plan that hopefully will incentivize companies not to sit on acreage and not develop it.
So in the Gulf of Mexico lease sale in March of 2010, more than 75% of the tracts that received bids had only a single bid. And so that dearth of industry competition is typical, unfortunately, of most offshore lease sales. These are leases being offered in areas in the Gulf of Mexico where there are nearly 80 billion barrels of oil and gas reserves, but oil companies aren't bidding for the majority of those leases. So if the oil companies aren't bidding on the vast majority of tracts offered in the Gulf, should we be rushing to offer them new areas off our beaches in the East and West Coast?
Congressman Markey, our view on the implementation of OXLA, which is a law that I execute with respect to offshore energy, is that we need to take into consideration a number of different factors under the law. On the Pacific, one of the requirements of the law is that we take into consideration the position of the states. And the states of Washington and Oregon and California are in strong opposition to development in those areas. On the Atlantic, there is a mix of opinion, and our decision has been to move forward with developing additional information on the Atlantic before there is any decision made about leasing with respect to the Mid and South Atlantic.
Mr. Secretary, when the Department released its five-year offshore drilling plan, the New York Times reported that, quote, David Hayes, the Deputy Interior Secretary, acknowledged that the infrastructure did not now exist to prevent or respond to a major spill in the Arctic. Mr. Hayes said a response could be compromised by inclement weather, a lack of deep harbors, a shortage of appropriate vessels, and inadequate oil transportation resources. The department was addressing those concerns, he said, and as a result had scheduled any possible lease sales in Alaska for the end of the five-year lease program. That's the New York Times reporting. So, Mr. Secretary, if the oil spill response infrastructure that Mr. Hayes has outlined is still not in place in 2015, will the department move forward with those lease sales in Arctic waters?
We can always pull those lease sales if the infrastructure is not in place. We do have concerns about the Coast Guard capability in the North Slope and in the North Seas, and those are issues which we are involved in discussion with stakeholders, including the oil and gas industry.
Yeah, the department's press release announcing the five-year plan stated, quote, the Arctic sales are scheduled late in the five-year period to facilitate further scientific study and data collection and longer-term planning for spill response preparedness and infrastructure. The independent BP Spill Commission also concluded that scientific understanding of environmental conditions in sensitive environments such as the Arctic is inadequate. What additional scientific study and data collection is needed in the Arctic? And if it has not been completed by 2015, will the department move forward with those lease sales?
That's a good point. We need additional science to be developed, and I'm going to have Director Bedreau answer a little bit on that question.
Yeah. My agency, the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management, is responsible for overseeing an environmental studies program that devotes millions of dollars to fund Arctic research in particular. That research is being conducted with respect to issues such as climate change, issues such as marine mammal migration patterns and populations, as well as ocean currents. All of this information is necessary to inform decision making as development in the Arctic proceeds and as the scale of development may increase over time, depending on the lease sales and depending on our evaluation of the preparedness. We will make those decisions at the appropriate time in the leasing schedule and evaluate the science as it stands at that time.
Time of the gentleman has expired. Mr. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Gohmert.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you, Secretary Salazar, for being here. You mentioned with regard to hydraulic fracking that was the Achilles heel in the production of natural gas. Now, when I came to Congress in January of 2005, we didn't know the full extent of the Marcellus Shale, the Haynesville Shale, the Barnett, all these shales that has produced tremendous amounts of natural gas. It is a way we could become independent from energy from people that don't like us. And so we keep hearing what ultimately appears to be scare tactics. We've had people say, gee, after hydraulic fracking, we could smell natural gas in our drinking water. We've had the EPA overreact, and we found out that their actions were not borne out by the scientific studies. And it would certainly have been news to the people in New London, Texas, in my district, back in the 1930s, that natural gas in its natural state had any smell at all, because they didn't know it had a smell, and that's how come the basement filled with natural gas and a spark set it off, and it created the worst school disaster in American history. And it was because of that legislation was put in place, as you're surely aware, that began to require an injection of smell so that people could smell natural gas once it was brought out into production. So I'm just curious, I know that there is a newest study that's been commissioned, because apparently people aren't happy with the ones that have said there is no relationship between hydraulic fracking and gas in drinking water. Are you aware of any current true scientific study that says otherwise?
I'm aware that there has been contamination from oil and natural gas wells into surface water supplies, and that's why
I'm talking about natural gas.
No, natural gas as well. So when we speak about...
Well, that's what the EPA director said, but that wasn't borne out.
Let me answer, okay? We are talking with members of the industry as well as others about moving forward with a thoughtful rule. The policy objective that we have in place is to be supportive of the natural gas.
So you're not answering my question now. My question was very direct. Are you aware of any scientific studies? My time is limited. I don't have time for this kind of thing.
Your time is limited. Let me give you the response. We, number one, support the development of
natural gas. That's not the answer, Secretary. Let's move on because you have no scientific studies that show that it does that. That was the question. Whether or not you support it was not the question. You can talk about that later on your time. Now, let me go to the Deepwater Horizon.
I have to respond to you. You know, the ear banging that you are engaging in is not helpful.
Sir, now you're using up my time to filibuster, and you wouldn't answer the question. Do you know of any scientific studies that support your position, yes or no?
There has been contamination of wells.
So the answer is you don't know of any scientific studies that document what you're alleging. Thank you. Let's move on to the Deepwater Horizon. We know that there were about 800 egregious violations by BP on Deepwater Horizon, while Exxon and Shell and others had one or two. Why was it that BP was allowed to keep drilling out in such a hazardous situation with so many violations?
You know, Congressman, the fact of the matter is that what happened to BP could have happened to other companies as well.
There is no other company, Secretary, that had that many egregious violations. And again, you're not answering my question. Why were they allowed to do that? There was no other company that had that many violations.
Congressman, our goal is to stand up the oil and gas industry in the Gulf of Mexico. We have succeeded in doing that. The rigs are back to work.
You sure have.
Back
you've
on
spit
the
it up.
Gas agenda. Our program is to develop a robust natural gas portfolio here in this country. We're supportive of the industry.
Well, speaking of standing up oil and gas, one of the first things you did as Secretary, you came in and declared that leases, 77 of them in Utah, that had been a result of a seven-year process, were leased at a midnight hour, and therefore you reneged, you breached the agreements, you canceled them, and said you weren't going to allow that to happen at the midnight hour. Sir, were you aware of the seven-year process that took place leading up, beginning in 2001 and leading up to the lease of those federal lands in Utah?
Congressman, we believe that we ought to drill in the right places with the right protections, and we ought not to be drilling in the vicinity or the scenery of our
I'm
national
sorry,
park.
Sir, did you not hear my question? My question was, were you aware of the seven-year process leading up to what you called the midnight hour lease of those lands in Utah?
It was a midnight hour lease, and I am aware of the seven-year process, which had faults in it, which ended up in litigation, and which the court said
Thank
was
you.
Wrong.
Thank you for answering that question. Yield back.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The gentlelady from Massachusetts, Ms. Songus, was recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Secretary Salazar, for being here with us today. And I remember at our last meeting, you committed to coming to Lowell, Massachusetts, and I'm going to follow up with you at some point, given our great national park there. I was pleased to see your announcement earlier this week naming Rear Admiral James Watson as the new director of the Bureau of Safety and Environmental Enforcement. And I know that Admiral Watson previously served as the deputy commander of the Coast Guard Atlantic Area Command and was designated as a federal on-scene coordinator for the all-of-government response to the Deepwater Horizon disaster. And so I trust that he has the experience and leadership to ensure that offshore drilling is done in a safe and secure way. I also want to commend the department's commitment to more thorough and comprehensive oil spill response plan review and enforcement through BSEE. I know this administration shares my view that we simply cannot allow risky drilling to take place in our public waterways without oil companies clearly demonstrating their ability to prevent, mitigate, or clean up any type of accident. It was a harsh lesson we learned with Deepwater Horizon. That's why I've introduced a Safer Drilling Act, which would require oil companies to have worst-case scenario response plans and the financial and technical means to clean up any spill before they drill for oil off our coast. However, as Congressman Markey has been discussing, your department has granted Shell Oil conditional approval of its plan to begin drilling exploratory wells in the Beaufort Sea off the North Slope of Alaska. I'm concerned that Shell's oil response plan does not have an acceptable worst-case scenario plan in place, and am specifically concerned that the company's worst-case plan is based on conditions in the Arctic in August when storms are rare, and there are not sustained periods of darkness and sea ice cover is limited. Given that this region is one of the harshest areas in the world in which to drill for oil, and that the proposed well sites are subject to fierce winds and high seas in the fall, as well as severe storms like the record storm that recently battered the coast of Alaska, what will your agency do to closely review and monitor Shell's proposed activities to make sure the company has an adequate and comprehensive worst-case scenario plan in place?
Thank you very much, Congresswoman. I will come to Massachusetts, and we will visit the National Park together. Thank you for the comments on Admiral Watson. He is a rare person to come in to take on this kind of responsibility that we have for America's oceans and energy development. I'm going to have Tommy Boudreau respond to your question on Shell.
Yeah. Thank you very much for that question. As you noted, the approval of Shell's Beaufort plan was conditional. Included among those conditions is that Shell demonstrate the ability to contain any spill or blowout related to their operation, and they'll have to prove that to us before they get a permit to drill. They'll also have to demonstrate before getting a permit to drill that they have adequate spill response and that we're satisfied with their spill response plan. Deputy Secretary Hayes is currently overseeing a high-level interagency working group that is focused on Shell's plan. Involved in that working group, of course, is Interior, my agency, as well as BSEE, NOAA, the EPA, and the Coast Guard. And we've been engaged with Shell on specific issues and concerns that we have with respect to their plan. And they will have to satisfy us that they've adequately addressed those concerns before they'll get a drilling permit under that exploration plan.
It's a very unique environment. So how do you develop your standards as to around what is appropriate or what, or, you know, what will work, what won't work, given just the very difficult circumstances up there?
There are challenging circumstances there. Our regulations set, I believe, a very high bar with respect to spill response, and you have to pay attention to the particular challenges in the Arctic when you evaluate the plan that's put forward. Some of the issues that we're considering, for example, is the length of the drilling season to address that issue that you referred to. You know, the legitimate question, what are you doing if there is an accident late in the drilling season? Those are the types of issues that we're focused on with Shell right now.
Can you imagine a situation in which your department considers every possibility and that Shell cannot come up with a plan to deal with the worst-case scenario, in which case you would not issue the permit?
Again, they will have to satisfy us that their plan is adequate to deal with the proposed operations that they put forward.
Thank you. I yield back.
Time of the gentlelady has expired. The gentleman from Colorado, Mr. Lambert, is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and Secretary Salazar, thanks for being here. It's good to talk to a fellow Coloradan. As I'm sure you know, increased regulations on an industry lead to regulatory uncertainty, which hinders that business being able to expand and create jobs because it's harder to plan their future. With oil shale in particular, a recent study indicates that over 350 American jobs could be created by the development of the oil shale. However, your department plans to issue hydrofracking regulations, which would undoubtedly hinder this development. But also, in the past, coming into office, the administration changed the terms of oil shale leases, making them so limited that industry has little interest in these tracts of land. Can you explain to this committee what economic analysis was used, if any, in making these decisions? And do you take job creation into effect when you issue regulations that have the effect of creating uncertainty and limiting business opportunities?
Congressman Lamborn, I appreciate the question, and the fact is that oil shale and development of the oil shale resources of Colorado, Utah, and Wyoming are very different from the issue of fracking of tight gases and other formations around the country. With respect to the oil shale of western Colorado, I think it's important for everyone to remember that there are some very significant questions that have not been answered, including the impact on water supplies of the Colorado River and other places. And so we have moved forward with pilot projects to develop the research and development, and there are a number of companies that are involved in at least Colorado and Utah that have been developing tremendous research on the oil shale potential. With respect to your question on natural gas and fracking, our program that we have not yet put out on the table because we're still in the process of developing is not meant to impede the development of natural gas. It's meant to support the development of natural gas so that we don't end up in a circumstance where we end up seeing the kinds of moratoria that we are seeing proposed in different states around the country.
So does your department use economic analysis like jobs created or jobs lost?
We see the work that we do in the department to be very connected to job creation and job security in America. And whether it's in the oil and gas arena or whether it's in the conservation world, we know the number of jobs that are created, and we have economic analysis and reports that I have created over the last several years that have been shared with members of Congress as well as with others that show the tremendous impact that we do have on job creation in this country.
But that's more in general terms. You don't apply that to particular regulations.
We look at that. I mean, the economic reality is something that we consider because of the fact that the President and the administration very much understand that the main challenge that we face here in the United States of America is job creation, so we think about it every day.
Okay, well, I wish it was linked to the actual regulations when they were being formulated. Changing the subject, knowing that the lead time, well, you said, first of all, in your opening statement, in your written statement, oil production from the federal OCS increased by a third from 2008 to 2010. And the clear implication there is that this administration is responsible for that in some way. Knowing that the lead time for bringing oil production to the market from offshore can be 5 to 10 years, when you include the entire leasing and permitting process, how much of this one-third increase that you claim on behalf of President Obama began under President Obama, and how much of it began under the previous administration?
You know, the policy of the United States, including presidents like President Clinton and President Bush and President Obama, has been to move forward and develop the oil and gas resources of the Gulf of Mexico, and about a third of the domestically produced oil and gas now comes from the Gulf of Mexico. So we have moved forward with a program that has supported the development of oil and gas and have weathered the major storm of the Deepwater Horizon, where many people were calling for a shutdown of oil and gas production in the Gulf. And so the fact that we were able to now have the rigs back at work in the Gulf of Mexico, given the national crisis that we went through, is something that I'm very proud to have accomplished.
Well, my specific question is, when you claim on behalf of the President a one-third increase, how much of that is he really responsible for, if any?
I would say we are all responsible for it. It's a shared accomplishment because the oil and gas production that we are seeing in the Gulf of Mexico, which has increased significantly over the last several years, is in large part dependent on the discovery that the oil and gas industry has made that has moved into deeper waters. So discoveries that are being made are good ones, and there are efforts on both exploration and development that we support.
Well, I like the fact that you say this is shared and should continue from administration to administration, from year to year. But when I see a claim being made that this president is responsible for this one-third increase, I don't see where that comes from.
Well, you know, the policy of the president is clear on energy, and that's to develop a secure energy future for the United States. And as I said in my opening statement, it does include oil and gas as part of that energy portfolio. We're supportive of oil and gas development along with alternative energies and fuel efficiencies.
Time of the gentleman has expired. Gentleman from Maryland, Mr. Sarbanes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Secretary, for being here. We appreciate it. Some of the questions you've been asked are, I think, based on a faulty premise, which is that environmental regulation and caution in terms of how we proceed with respect to potential impact on the environment is sort of inherently inimical to economic development and jobs, when in fact there's a tremendous amount of economic benefit that comes from smart stewardship of our environment. I mean, I come from a state, obviously, that places the Chesapeake Bay as a number one treasure, and I've become more familiar in recent months with a lot of the information about how valuable the Chesapeake Bay is to the economy of Maryland and the states in the Chesapeake Bay watershed. I mean, I think the Chesapeake Bay watershed has been valued at $1 trillion in terms of what it generates for the economy. There is, in terms of just the commercial seafood industry in Maryland, Virginia, you're talking about $2 billion in sales, $1 billion in income, 41,000 local jobs. So if we don't do the right thing by these kinds of natural resources that we have, we could also undermine tremendous economic opportunity going forward. And I just wanted to put that on the record. I'm very concerned about the fact that we move carefully and smartly with respect to the development of this hydraulic fracturing process for extracting natural gas. And I understand that it represents a real opportunity, as do you, and as does the administration. Many regard natural gas as sort of the bridge from a traditional dependence on fossil fuels of a certain kind to more renewable energies. So there's great potential there, there's great promise, but if that promise is as tremendous as it appears to be, we need to move, I think, in a deliberate and careful way and make sure that this practice is done properly and safely. And if you look at the Marcellus Shale, which is the sort of the recent gold rush opportunity that's being viewed from the natural gas industry, the footprint it has over the Chesapeake Bay watershed is substantial. You're talking about New York, Pennsylvania, West Virginia, Virginia, Western Maryland, parts of Western Maryland that are implicated by this potential. So we got to make sure that we're doing this in a smart and prudent way. And I commend you for wanting to get more information about the process, and for starters, just what's in this composition of chemicals that goes into the process. And as I understand it, the agency is going to be insisting on more disclosure with respect to those chemicals, and I hope also monitoring the effect of that on public lands, and that can set a good standard for how the industry ought to operate across the board, both on public lands and on non-public lands. I do want to point out that the industry keeps asserting that, you know, there's all this evidence that hydraulic fracturing can't contaminate underground sources of drinking water. But very recently, the EPA has released some data based on some study that it's been doing in Wyoming, in Pavilion, Wyoming, that suggests that there's an aquifer there that has benzene levels, that's a known carcinogen, that were 50 times higher than what is considered safe in terms of the threshold. And they also found 2-butyl oxyethanol evidence there, another cancer-causing chemical in the drinking water. So this is real. This is a real potential harm that we have to be on the lookout for. And I understand your testimony indicates the department is evaluating whether it would be beneficial to amend existing requirements with respect to the management of water produced, the sort of wastewater produced from hydrofracking. And I was curious when the department is planning on making a decision on whether to amend the requirements with respect to wastewater. If you could just speak to that.
Congressman Sarbanes, thank you for the question. And first, let me say I do agree that I think we can both protect the environment and develop our oil and gas resources on public lands and other places in the country. With respect to fracking and the timeline for us moving forward. We don't have a timeline. We're still in the process of gathering information and putting together what will be a proposed rule. But we have taken advantage of the information that we've gotten from stakeholders, including a summit that I had on hydraulic fracking, or a forum that I had on hydraulic fracking in the department about a year ago. And so the pieces of it are still coming together. There are three general subject areas. One is the wellbore integrity. The second is disclosure. And the third would be dealing with what we call the flowback water issues. But no final decisions have been made, and there will be a continued process to bring in the input from the stakeholders.
Thank you.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The gentleman from Virginia, Mr. Whitman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Secretary, colleagues. Thank you so much for joining us today. First of all, I want to thank you on behalf of the citizens of the Commonwealth for your work in protecting and preserving historic Fort Monroe there in Hampton, Virginia. That is, I think, a great example of a collaborative approach where folks get together, they see a need, and that national monument designation now that will be put in place will allow us to preserve a very significant historic landmark there, and it also shows how we can come together and do what's best for our natural resources. And I'm sure you agree that this is really a result of broad citizen support and also a bipartisan approach from both federal, state, and local officials. So it's a great opportunity there, and as was highlighted, I think it's going to create jobs for the region, and really it's a win-win situation. If you look at that as an example, I think it sets the tone for what we can do with offshore gas and oil development. If you look there in Virginia, you see the same situation. You see broad citizen support. You see bipartisan support for development of oil and gas in the offshore region there off of Virginia. We think that's extraordinarily important as we go forward. And it was disappointing when the announcement came out on the 2012-2017 Outer Continental Shelf Oil and Gas Leasing Program that Lease 220 in Virginia was not included as part of that. And as you know, by excluding that, that takes away, I think, an opportunity for us to responsibly develop our fossil fuels offshore there. And we all know that it has a significant economic impact, upwards of $20 billion annually, and creates a number of significant jobs, great infrastructure there in order to be able to support that. And I want to bring to your attention a letter from myself and other colleagues from the Virginia Congressional Delegation to ask you to reconsider that determination made on Lease 220. And, Mr. Chairman, without objection, I'd like that to be entered in the record.
Without objection, it will be part of the record.
I want to ask this. As you look as across the board with that broad bipartisan support, you look, the governor of Virginia, the Virginia legislature, local officials, state officials have all said, let's go forward with the Lease 220. And we've seen citizens in the area, too. With that widespread support, I'm wondering why the department determined not to go forward with this in the 2012-2017 plan. And I want to get some of your reasons behind that. I also look, too, and some of the other reasons given in the report as to why some of the other areas were opened up, such as in the Pacific, and it talked about the broad support there with local and state governments as a reason that those areas were going to be opened up. And I'm wondering, is the broad support there in Virginia less of a factor in making a determination than broad support elsewhere when these determinations were made? I'd like to get your perspective on that.
Thank you very much, Congressman Whitman. And let me just say that I appreciate the work that you do on the Migratory Bird Conservation Commission. You have been a leader in conservation with Congressman Dingell and with Senator Cochran, as well as with Senator Pryor. And I appreciate the time that you spend advancing the conservation agenda for hunters and anglers in the United States of America. With respect to lease sale 220 in Virginia, let me say that since 2 years ago, we have developed additional information from the Department of Defense that shows that there are significant conflicts between oil and gas development and the military needs within the triangle that was included in the lease sale 220. And so our view is that we need to continue to develop additional information to see if we can deconflict the important mission of supporting the defense and military needs of our country, which is also so important not only to the country but to Virginia, and at the same time look at developing additional information on the Atlantic with respect to its oil and gas potential. But it's really, at this point in time, in large part, the conflict issues that were raised by the Department of Defense with respect to Lease Sale 220.
Well, let me ask this then. As the discussion takes place not only about offshore gas and oil development, but also about wind development offshore, the discussions have taken place on both, about potential interference there on both. It seems that there is an accelerated discussion on the wind side, but not the same effort there on the oil and gas development side. I would say that both of them obviously are issues that we need to address with the Navy and other branches, but that they ought to both be pursued at the same time. I think both of the conflicts are very, very similar, and to me that they ought to be able to be taken up and those issues taken care of in a fairly timely manner. And it seems like to me to spread this out over another 5 years is, well, less than what we're capable of. We're capable of sitting down and getting those things done. And I've spoken with the leadership in the Navy who have said that they want to pursue aggressively those discussions to make sure we get to a point to make sure that we develop all of the potential in that outer continental shelf.
Time of the real briefly, Mr. Secretary, if you want to respond to that.
You know, I don't have a disagreement with respect to making sure that we are being, as Bob Abbey often says, smart from the start, including in the outer continental shelf. And so our work with the Department of Defense and the Navy will give us significant additional information with respect to not only Lease Sale 220, but also the seismic work that we are moving forward with will give us additional information on the Atlantic.
The gentleman from Georgia, Mr. Brown, is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Secretary, the Environmental Protection Agency has proposed and is in the process of enacting regulations targeting traditional inexpensive sources of energy. The Utility Act, Boiler Act, GHGs, and CSAP are among the more recent and well-known examples which will result not only in an increase in energy costs, but result in more natural gas being used for power generation and for industrial manufacturing. Are these rules a factor when considering access for natural gas production, and if not, why?
I would refer those questions to Administrator Jackson in terms of the EPA. Our own view is that there will be a robust demand for natural gas.
Sorry, what I'm asking, I apologize for interrupting you, but please answer my question. Are you and your department considering the EPA rules? Is there any communication between you and EPA on the rules that they're trying to enact, the regulations that they're trying to enact, which is going to reduce production of inexpensive energy? Are you, as y'all look at energy production, particularly for natural gas or for oil, anything else, are you having communications with the EPA on considering their rules and regulations that they're enacting on energy producers, as well as the resource development? Are you considering or communicating with EPA in any way on this?
Let me say that we look for ways in which we can work with EPA to solve problems. So, for example, on a major project in Utah, the Greater Natural Butte Gas Project, we put together a best practices program that included EPA and Anadarko, the developer in that arena. And as a result of those best practices solutions, we're going to be able to protect the environment, and the company is going to be able to move forward with development of in excess of 3,000 wells.
Well, Secretary, you didn't answer my question. Do you consider those regulations, and do you have any communication with EPA as you look forward to developing energy resources that are under your jurisdiction?
We have communications with EPA, but we also recognize that EPA has its own authority, and Administrator Jackson abides by the law and is moving forward in implementing her responsibilities at her department.
Well, if these interagency communications do indeed take place, would you agree that it is the apparent policy of this administration to increase the cost of energy and to dramatically limit domestic access to those energy resources?
Congressman, I would disagree with that, Congressman Brown. I believe that when you look at what we have done in terms of moving forward with a robust energy portfolio for the United States of America, I think the facts speak for themselves.
Well, Secretary, I disagree with you on that regard.
I'm surprised.
Well, the thing is, what it appears to me is that the policies of this administration are increasing the cost of all energy production. We're not having the access to an all-of-the-above energy policy that will allow us to develop natural gas, oil, clean coal technology, as well as alternative forms of energy. And I see very little communication between agencies, between your agency as well as EPA. I see the EPA making rules without consideration to the economic cost and even utilizing what appears to me to be junk science in forming their regulations. And so what I see coming from not only from EPA, but also your department, policies that are going to drive up the cost of all goods and services because energy costs are going to go up. And I think it's absolutely disastrous. It's going to cost thousands, if not millions, of jobs. It's going to hurt our economy. And I highly recommend that you communicate with EPA, you take into consideration these human elements of jobs and economy as y'all go forward in developing.
Would the gentleman yield?
Certainly.
It seems to be the line of questioning that you're pursuing is very important, because both the response of the Secretary was that both agencies have their responsibility. The real collision course potentially is the issue of American job creation and American energy production as it relates to what EPA's influence is. And that seems to be a conflict. And I think your line of questioning, and correct me if I'm wrong, was very simply, how is the interaction between Interior and EPA, and for lack of a better word, what is supposed to be the trump card as to what the policy is? Is that a fair way to characterize what your statement was?
Absolutely, Mr. Chairman, and the answer I got from the Secretary does not give me any confidence if there's any communication.
Yeah, Mr. Secretary, in that line of questioning, if you could respond back to us in writing on that, the committee would be very appreciative of that.
I will do that, and if I may, just to make a comment here in response to Congressman Brown, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
We work closely with EPA on a number of different issues. They have their own legal authority, but I will give you two examples where we have worked very closely. I mentioned the one in Utah where we're moving forward with natural gas development in a place that had been stalled because of litigation, because of the best practices programs that we have put together. And with respect to many other issues, including the issue of hydraulic fracturing, we have continued dialogue with EPA on what we're doing and what they are doing. And so there's a tremendous amount of coordination that does, in fact, occur.
Gentleman from Louisiana is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, as you know, I represent Louisiana, Northwest Louisiana, the area of the Haynesville Shale. And just to give you an idea of the impact that's had on us, we've had an increase of close to 58,000 jobs just in 2009 alone. And from 2008 to 2009, exploration companies invested over $11.5 billion and generated $642.3 million in state tax revenue. Tremendous job impact, tremendous economic impact. And we're talking about, of course, natural gas, shale formations, hydrofracking, which is necessary. That's the only way we can get it out economically. Hydrofracking has been around for 60 years. The EPA took a look at it in 2005, found absolutely no problems with it. It's under regulation in my state by DEQ. We have 10 to 20 regulators moving about constantly to make sure all the right things are done. If there's a need to find out what's in the hydrofracking fluid, no problem with that being provided if needed. Are you, sir, aware of any deaths or serious injuries to humans as a result of the hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of episodes, the 60 years of hydrofracking that's been performed?
No, I'm not.
And do you, sir, know, can you tell me, what is the depth of the typical aquifer, that is, the water supply that's in the ground?
I think across the country you would find great variance, and it will depend on the area that you are doing the drilling. And I understand very much that the zones that are the hydrocarbon producing zones that produce natural gas are generally below the water supply zones for domestic usage.
Right.
And so that's why issues like wellbore integrity are so important as you move forward.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned that. How many levels of casing is around a typical drilling rig in order to protect the drill hole from the aquifer itself?
Let me defer on that question to Director Abbey, see if he knows the technical answer.
Well, I don't know the technical answer, but I do know that the Bureau of Land Management is quite firm.
Wait, let me interrupt you because I got more questions.
Okay.
These are very simple questions. How deep is an aquifer? It's about 1,000 feet, gentlemen. This is something that you guys should know.
Well, the aquifers vary from region to region.
Yes, but they're approximately in that range. How deep do we drill when we get down to the shale? How deep is that typically?
Well, in some cases, it's as deep as 4,000 feet.
Okay. 2 miles is actually more like it. So the point being that the aquifer, the water supply itself, is way up at the surface of the earth. And all the activity where the hydrofracking fluid is, which, by the way, is 99.5% water and sand, is below the surface by about 2 miles, protected by rock formation. So I think that it's very easy to understand why no one's had serious harm as a result of it. We can speculate, we can talk about hypotheticals all the time. But the point here is it is a regulated industry. It's producing inexpensive energy and doing a great job. It is not harming people. And certainly I would say that the Solyndra affair has harmed more people than hydrofracking has in 60 years. So I'm really at a loss to understand why now the Interior Department has got to jump in and begin regulating this. And by the way, sir, the rules have been promised to us and yet to come out, but everything that the Interior Department touches, and we'll get on the OCS a little later, I have questions about that, causes delay and higher cost of production. So why is it that now, in view of all this that I've stated, why do now we have to go out and add more red tape, more regulations, when this country is in desperate need of jobs, good-paying jobs, and lower energy costs?
Congressman Fleming, I appreciate the question, and I respectfully disagree with your conclusions. The fact is that we believe that natural gas is a very important part of our energy portfolio for the future. We also believe that disclosure is something that needs to be looked at so that we don't end up creating a circumstance where we see moratoria created throughout the United States where we have natural gas development. Wellbore integrity is essential in order to be able to assure that we don't have a water quality.
Sir, you don't even know how many layers of casing go around a typical drill. So if the very top level doesn't know the very basics of the technology, why is it that you somehow feel you can insinuate yourself into the process?
Congressman Fleming, and as a, having dealt with a lot of oil and gas wells, including the Macondo well, there was a huge question about wellbore integrity on that particular well. And it's a question that you face with every single well that is drilled. And so the industry knows about wellbore integrity, and we require wellbore integrity, and having that being a part of what we do as a regulator is something that we're examining. We've not yet reached a conclusion, but we support natural gas development here in the United States.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The gentleman from Colorado, Mr. Kaufman.
Thank you, Secretary Salazar, for attending this hearing on the future of oil and gas development on federal lands. As a member of Colorado, I'm sure you understand how I often hear from my constituents. I think you were in my shoes once in a related role. The valuable 8.4 million acres of land in Colorado controlled by the Bureau of Land Management are subject to a litany of federal regulations that have gone well beyond their purpose of protecting lands that have become economically burdensome. Every day I receive correspondence regarding the frustrations my constituents have with BLM and the land use regulations that hamper or suspend otherwise viable mineral and energy development. Under the Obama administration, these restrictions have only inflamed an already tough situation while burning an economy with an in-state unemployment rate of 8.3%. This committee has developed several proposals that not only relieve restrictions on federal lands to promote energy production, environmentally responsible energy production, but have also crafted policies that will aid in both our deficit crisis and bringing down our high unemployment rate. If this administration is serious about solving these problems, then I would think it would be more proactive in working with the Natural Resources Committee. However, the members of this committee and I are continuously turned back by the policies of the Department of Interior and the President's administration that not only add to the regulatory burden for domestic energy production, for domestic energy production. We could create jobs, move towards energy independence, and increase federal revenues if we allow development to take place. This is no more apparent than in the recent decision by President Obama and the State Department to delay the Keystone XL pipeline project. However, this is ill-advised, and this is really a purely political decision by the President, who will do more that will do more than just economic harm, but it will have a grave national security implication as well. I was saddened that President Obama was persuaded in his decision, not by the economic benefits of the project, but by far-left environmental interest groups. While the President waits until after the election in November of 2012, millions of Americans are looking for work now. The pipeline decision has two very important impacts on Americans, both on national security and the future viability of our economy. First, as a Marine Corps combat veteran, I believe it's imperative we take into consideration the national security implications of our energy policy. The United States currently imports roughly 50% of the petroleum we use, and the Natural Resources Committee has been on the forefront of trying to curb this dangerous dependence on foreign oil by crafting logical domestic energy policies during the 112th Congress. Like many of the proposals my colleagues and I have put forth in this committee, the Keystone Pipeline Project will help our nation reduce our dependency on sometimes hostile foreign sources of energy. In 2010 alone, the United States imported over 1 trillion barrels of oil to the United States from OPEC countries, many of which have unstable governments. While I fully support greater American production, this pipeline is not only in our nation's best interest for national security, but economically beneficial to us as well. By increasing oil imports from Canada, a secure, stable, and long-standing friendly neighbor, the United States will have less to import from volatile, unstable regimes overseas. Secondly, many of my constituents, and some of your former ones, are looking to Congress for leadership. The national unemployment rate is 9.1%, and there is very little proof this number will improve in the coming months. That is why it is so discouraging to see that President Obama and the Department of the Interior have been so obstructionist when it comes to domestic energy and mineral development. Instead of working with the Natural Resources Committee, your department has been making misleading statements about your energy record. You continue to praise the amount of production and revenue that comes from oil and gas development on public lands, but the BLM has not approved a major oil and gas NEPA project on public lands in the West since 2010. In your opinion piece in Politico on Monday, Mr. Secretary, you mentioned that onshore oil production from public lands has increased 5%.
May we finish up real quickly, if you would?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to enter my statement in the record And Mr. Secretary, what plans, if you could submit this for the record since I'm front of us too long, Mr. Secretary, what plans and the analysis used for those plans, if any, does your department have to supplement the loss of production, jobs, revenues, and safety this delay will have? I would like for you, Mr. Secretary, to develop and send back to me and this committee a written response directly addressing these questions.
If you do that, Mr. Secretary, it would be very appreciative since we did go over time on that one. So, Chair recognizes the gentleman from Florida, Mr. Rivera.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Mr. Secretary, for being here. It was great seeing you down south, my district in the Everglades, and thank you for all of your efforts on Everglades restoration. I'd like to ask you about an issue that I think not only certainly impacts the ecosystem in South Florida, but perhaps in the southeast region of the United States, and that is oil drilling off the coast of Cuba. It's my understanding that in order for a foreign government-owned company to operate in the U.S. and bid on leases in the U.S., they must first be incorporated in the United States. Is that correct?
I don't know the answer to that question.
Okay. Well, recently, my staff contacted the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management and the Bureau of Land Management to try to get a list of all foreign government-owned companies that have leases in the United States. And they were surprised to learn that the department doesn't keep a database of what companies are foreign government-owned. The foreign government-owned companies are just mixed in with the regular privately owned companies. So I believe it would be useful to at least be able to track these companies and what government owns them. Could you help me with that, get that information?
We will. And let me ask whether Director Abby or Boudreau have any information on that question.
It is correct that in order to obtain a federal OCS lease, a company needs to be registered in the United States through the relevant State Department.
Perfect. That's okay. I just want to make sure that I can get the information on the foreign government-owned companies. If you could help me with that?
Yes.
That would be helpful. Thank you. A few months ago, I believe in June, you were in Spain and spoke to Repsol officials regarding their proposed drilling plans in Cuban waters. Is that correct, Mr. Secretary?
That is correct.
And in that meeting, or in any other meetings you've had with Repsol officials, did you a topic come up or reiterate U.S. policy on doing business with state sponsors of terrorism or have any discussions to discourage their actions in Cuba?
You know, our focus, Congressman Rivera, has been to make sure that we do everything within the legal boundaries that we can operate in to protect the environment and the people of the United States.
So I would assume that to mean more of a cooperative effort to make sure and protect the people of the United States, which is important to make sure and do every possible measure to do that. But you're telling me nothing was ever done by you to discourage their participation in collaborating with a state sponsor of terrorism in those offshore oil drilling efforts?
We do not have authority over other countries and what they do with respect to their...
I understand. No, you can't stop them, but do we ever try to discourage?
Our program, Congressman Rivera, has been to make sure that we do everything we can within our legal power.
Okay. Well, let's talk about
the environment of the United States.
Let's talk about the legal power. In terms of the... did you ever bring up having the Bureau of Industry and Security also be allowed to inspect the rig to ensure that the Export Administration Act and the Export Administration Regulations 10% de minimis U.S. content rule were being respected? Speaking of legal authority, has that issue ever come up?
You know, Congressman Rivera, this is an issue where the State Department and other agencies have the lead, and we are participating because of our expertise. But I do not know whether those conversations took place, and I don't have an answer to your question.
Okay, well, recently, colleagues of mine here, along with Chairman Ileana Ross-Layton, sent a letter to the President regarding this issue. Mr. Chairman, with your permission, I'd like to ask that letter be submitted for the record.
Without objection, it will be part of the record.
Thank you. I think it's of great concern by the lack of effort in this administration-wide, whether it be your agency, State Department, or anyone else, that no effort has been made to prevent a state sponsor of terrorism to drill approximately 60 to 70 miles off of Florida's coast and providing economic aid and comfort to the dying Castro dictatorship. And I hope that in the future, the administration will do everything to make sure that companies comply with sanctions that apply to businesses that do cooperate with sponsors of state terrorism by perhaps, in your agency, withdrawing leases on federal lands and waters. That could be a start to certainly send a signal that this type of activity is certainly frowned upon, collaborating with terrorist regimes. Finally, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to draw attention of my colleagues to legislation I've introduced with Congresswoman Ross Layton and Congressman Diaz-Balart and Representative Sears, the Foreign Oil Spill Liability Act, that would apply the same Oil Pollution Act responsibilities and liabilities and Clean Water Act penalties that a domestic responsible party would face to a foreign responsible party for a spill that pollutes U.S. waters and beaches. The penalties and liabilities would be triple. Currently, the burden is much lower on foreign spillers, forcing the American taxpayer to cover the cleanup costs, and members can contact my office if they wish more information on that legislation. That's all I have. Thank you, Mr. Secretary.
I thank the gentleman, and his time has expired. And the chair recognizes the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Flores. I asked Mr. Floyd, move to a microphone so we can pick this up since we have,
you could always move.
You're not
this,
being
you could always yet. Move to this side, Congressman Flores.
We'll take
well, there's lots, one of the things to note is there's lots of room over there.
So I would discourage that, however.
Well, don't worry, I won't do that. Secretary Salazar, Director Abbey, and Director Bedreau, thank you for joining us today. I have several questions. I'll get through these as quickly as I can. I'd like to start out by asking the staff to put up a chart that has lead times for leasing and drilling and production. And while we're waiting on that, let me read to you what OSCILA specifies in terms of leasing plans. It says, a leasing plan is supposed to, and I quote, best meet national energy needs for the five-year period following its approval or disapproval, unquote. Now, if we look at this chart up here, there's two red diamonds and a green diamond are the operable diamond, operable time points to look at. If you see up toward the left-hand side of the chart, you'll see the red diamond says lease sale. Then if you drift down about 4.5 years to the middle of the chart, you'll see a green diamond that shows where a discovery is made. And then if you go down to the lower right-hand corner of the chart, you'll see a red diamond that shows when first production begins. The average time period from the lease sale to the first production is 9.5 years. So for this administration to take credit for a 30% increase in oil production, I think goes beyond the pale. Now, but this is important because it leads into the next part of the question. Bonus revenues are the direct indicator of lease sale activity. In 2008, our bonus revenues to the federal government were $9.7 billion. Last year, it was about $1.2 billion, and this year, it's less than $100 million. Now, in light of that, in this chart, what does the Department of Interior project that oil production is going to be from the offshore in light of your new lease sale? And then we'll drill into that a little further. What's it going to mean in terms of employment activity, oil and gas prices, GDP impact, things like that? What economic analysis do you have that backs up your proposed leasing plan, particularly with respect to production?
Congressman Flores, under the Outer Continental Shelf Lands Act, there are a number of different factors and considerations that have to be taken into account. And the energy needs of the nation are one of those factors that we do take into account. We see robust production going on in the Gulf of Mexico today. That's production that has been coming online and will continue to come online. And our expectation is that with 12 additional lease sales in the next
5-year period in the Gulf of Mexico that we'll see robust production, especially with the kind of discoveries that are being made. But we're making additional lease sales, additional acreage available in order to continue that development.
Do you have any production numbers, production estimates that you can share?
Let me ask Director Bedrow, and we probably do. Tommy?
Yeah, the EIA puts out production estimates that speak for the administration in terms of production.
And do they have they? I'm going to run out of time here. Have they baked in the last lease sale plan?
No, they haven't baked in the last lease sale plan. But what they do reflect is projections both offshore and onshore based on areas under current production.
Okay. Well, what we need to do is, to the extent you can put this together, I'd like to see analysis that bakes in the current lease sale plan. Because that's important, because rubber meets the road in terms of production. And lease sales are, as you can see from this chart, are the ultimate prerequisite to production from public lands and public waters. I want to go through sort of area by area on the approach that was taken in putting together this plan. In Alaska, it says that there's single sales in each of Beaufort and Chukchi to take into account significant inventory of yet undeveloped leases in frontier areas. Now, just in a couple of words, why are those areas undeveloped today?
They're undeveloped, frankly, because there is not the infrastructure up there to develop them, and the findings have not been made at this point in time to be able to move forward.
Or it could be permits, right? Could be permits, too. They can't get, for instance, the Shell has been trying for years to get a permit to Chukchi Sea and can't get it from the EPA. So our federal government is causing that problem. So that's why it's undeveloped. And let's go to the next one. In the Pacific, and it says areas off the Pacific coast are not included in the proposed program, which seeks to accommodate the recommendations of governors of coastal states and state and local agencies, an important priority established by OSCLA, right? Okay, so you and off the Pacific, we paid attention to the governors and local interests that said, we don't want you to drill here. And so you said, okay, we're not going to drill here, right?
That is one factor. It's an important OSCLA factor. There are other factors involved as well.
Okay, now, well, let's move to the Atlantic. And in the Atlantic, it says a number of specific considerations supported the Secretary's decision to not include these areas, including lack of infrastructure, blah, blah, blah. Now, Virginia has specifically said, we're ready to go. We'd like to drill. Now, the reason that was given is, and let me put this in sort of a real estate developer's terms. I'm going to go develop a new subdivision, and you're saying that because the developer hasn't put in the streets and sewer systems and so forth, we're not going to sell them the land. Well, that doesn't make sense. That's backwards. You have to have the leases as a prerequisite before any of the infrastructure's there, right?
Congressman Flores, the reality of Virginia is what I spoke to with Congressman Whitman in his questioning, and that is that you have very significant conflicts with the military needs, which are so important to the country. We're not going to do anything that is going to step back on supporting the needs of the Navy.
Okay, so we're...
Now the gentleman has expired, so...
Thank you for the minute, Tim Grace.
Yeah. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Louisiana, Mr. Landry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, I want to commend you and thank you and your staff for getting involved and helping me get a meeting down in the regional office in New Orleans, because I believe that it's important for Congress, it's Congress's role to regulate the regulator. And so I appreciate you getting involved and seeing that it's important to allow congressmen to go down there and visit the regional offices and so forth. So I thank you. I don't know if you had a chance to read the Wall Street Journal today, because there was an article that said that crude cruises just shy of $100. And if you read through the article, you will see that the reason that crude prices are escalating, according to the Wall Street Journal, which is a periodical that Director Bromwich liked to use about a month ago in telling us that the Gulf was back to work, says that the reason that crude prices are up is that domestic supplies are on the way down. They're predicting that domestic domestic production is on the decline. And you see, last year I explained, I sent out a comment that I don't think the administration understands. You can't turn the oil and gas industry on and off like a light switch. And I think that this article is one of many that are going to start to prove that I'm right and prove that y'all guys are really putting us in a precarious situation. Because if oil is at $100 a barrel today, okay, when we're at the slow driving season, when gasoline prices start to decline, God help us in May and June and July, which of course is at the time when your boss is going to be running, which I think he's very sensitive to. So I think that this is an opportunity for us to recognize that we have to increase our production and open up some additional areas. Now, the lease sales can create significant revenue for the federal government. We've heard that. What kind of impact would lease sale 222, if allowed to move forward, make on our economy and on our demand for energy in this country?
So lease sale 220 in Virginia?
No, yeah, 222, I think it is.
222 is the eastern goal.
Are you 222 or 220?
222.
222, is that one of our lease sales?
Upcoming in the Eastern Gulf.
It's an upcoming lease sale in the Eastern Gulf that was opened up under the GOMESA Act of
right, but it's not being conducted in 2012.
It is part of our 2012 to 2017 plan.
But the lease sale is not going to be conducted in 2012. It's not going to be auctioned.
Let me ask next
year.
Yeah. There will be a Western Gulf lease sale on December 14th of this year. Next year, in May or June, there'll be a consolidated Central Gulf sale, which, as reflected in the national assessment that Ranking Member Markey displayed at the beginning of this hearing, is actually the richest area in the Gulf. That consolidated sale will take place in May or June.
So are you saying that 222 actually will occur next year? I mean, it's just a yes or no, because we don't have a lot of time.
Yeah, we're putting out, and as a matter of fact, this week, we'll be putting out a notice on that sale.
Great, thank you. Let me ask you this question. Did you consider in your five-year plan addressing the needs of those players indirectly affected by the oil spill and subsequent moratorium, such as shallow water operators and lease extensions? That's kind of where I'm trying to go here. I know that y'all gave some extensions to about 99% of those stakeholders in deep water, but we've got no answer as to those shallow water players, whether those, because they were indirectly affected, if we would extend their leases as we did the deep water players.
Let me answer one of your questions, and that's on the dollars and the value of crude and the Wall Street Journal article, and I'll have Tommy respond directly to your last question. The price of oil is set on the global market, and the program that we have put out both onshore as well as offshore is one that is going to bring additional energy production here in the United States.
Wait, I hate to stop you. That is partially true, but Brent crude has actually been, there's been a significant gap between Brent crude and Texas Intermediate, which is over at Cummings, and so the price in this article, you will see that the price that I'm talking about is the American crude that's being priced on a NYMEX. So they're saying that the reason that it is going up is because of domestic supplies are going down. So that's an effect directly based upon on domestic production, not on worldwide production, on domestic production, because when Libya was taken off the market, the Brent crude shot up. So you see, you actually are able to see the differences between the two.
I would only say, Congressman, that the facts speak for themselves, that we are moving forward with production of oil and gas, and we continue to produce more today than was being produced even 2 years ago.
Time of the gentleman has expired. Gentleman from Nevada, Mr. Amadei.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, Mr. Secretary.
Morning.
I've gone over your opening statement, and I've just got a couple questions based on that. You indicated in the introduction that President has stressed the administration is committed to promoting safe and responsible domestic oil and gas production as part of a broad energy strategy that will protect consumers. Protect consumers from what?
We need to make sure that we address the goal of the nation's energy security. That's the essence of the President's blueprint on energy. And at the heart of it is national security, economic security, and environmental security. And it's an issue that's been debated for a long time. The fact is that we in this administration are making real progress on all aspects of getting us to energy security.
So it's kind of protecting from those three things, national, economic, and environmental security, national defense, economic, and environmental security. That's the, those are my words, not yours, but generally that's in the ballpark.
I don't know what specific language you're referring to in the statement. Maybe you can refresh my memory.
I don't want to spend a lot of time on it, but your statement says one of the objectives is to protect consumers. So I want to know what you're protecting consumers from as a result of what we're discussing here today.
I think consumers are being protected in a variety of ways under our energy plan, including the fact that this president has been able to achieve the highest fuel efficiency efforts in the history of the United States of America. And that was with support of the auto industry as well as many others who were involved in those decisions. So the fact that we are becoming a nation that is actually producing cars that are being now sold through a healthy auto industry is one of those ways in which the consumers are being protected.
Okay, thank you. If you have anything to follow up on that in terms of the economic things, if I could get that offline, I'd appreciate it in terms of jobs, whether it's energy production, whether it's auto production, whatever other protections. I know this is a limited time frame. If you want to elucidate on that in writing, Grader, I would appreciate that. Yeah. I also know later on when we're talking about the fracking issues, I'm on page 4 of your statement, the third from the bottom paragraph, and maybe Mr. Abbey will understand my sensitivity to this. There's a line there that says, in addition, we are evaluating whether it would be beneficial to amending existing requirements that govern management of water that is produced following development. Now, everybody knows there's no coastlines on Nevada, and Mr. Abbey can understand there is a little bit of energy production in the Silver State, but when a guy whose state relies extensively on groundwater sees a federal agency starting to talk about management of water that's produced from drilling, I would like you to elucidate on that. Is this the first step into getting into state water law, wherever it may be, or just give me some sense of what management of water produced following development of what is drilling means, because I'm interested in knowing where that's headed.
Thank you, Congressman. It is not at all an effort to get into state water law. Water law is what is in the sovereign nature of the state. But I want to direct Rabbi to talk about the flowback water issue for just a minute, because it's the issue that I think you are probably most concerned about.
Well, and you know what? I appreciate your answer, and that hits what I want to hit as much as I look forward to talking to Mr. Abbey. Mr. Chairman, with your permission, I'd like to yield back the rest of my time to the gentleman from Texas, Mr. Flores. Thank you, Mr. Secretary. The
gentleman from Flores is recognized.
In the latest lease plan, there is a proposal to change the form of the lease, and I'm concerned about what we've got here. If you look at, let me ask you this: did you get any public or stakeholder feedback on your proposed changes,
Director Boudreau?
Yes, we specifically engaged industry, including API, on the lease form. Prior to publication of the lease form, we received a letter from API laying out questions and concerns they had about the amendments, and then I invited API in to sit down, go over the issues with me and with my staff, and we did that before making any final decisions about the lease form.
Okay, well, I've read the same letter, and it doesn't look like many of the proposals, many of the concerns that they had were addressed. And in particular, one of the areas I'm concerned about is the proposed changes to Section 1 of the lease form look like they're totally unlawful with respect to Section 5A of OSCLA. I'm concerned. I mean, how are we going to implement a lease form that has an unlawful provision?
The amendment to Section 1 of the lease form is not unlawful. In fact, it essentially states a truism, which is that an operator who acquires a lease is subject to regulation, and any changes in regulation that may occur in the future that do not specifically conflict with the terms of that lease. That is an inarguable position in my view, and yet it is a position that in litigation companies have pursued. And so this is to make completely clear that in addition to the requirements of the lease, operators are required to comply with our regulations. Most responsible companies wouldn't have an objection to that.
Well, there are time of the gentleman has expired. I want to get everybody to have an opportunity. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Ohio, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Mr. Secretary, for being here today. Mr. Secretary, you're probably aware that I introduced legislation called the World War II Memorial Prayer Act of 2011 that would direct you or a future Secretary of the Interior to place a plaque or an inscription of the prayer that President Roosevelt prayed with the nation on the morning of D-Day. On November 3rd, Director Abbey testified before one of our subcommittees on behalf of your department regarding H.R. 2070, this piece of legislation. And in the department's testimony, Director Abbey testified, and I quote, that placing the President's prayer, D-Day prayer, on the World War II memorial will necessarily dilute this elegant memorial's central message and its ability to clearly convey that message to move, educate, and inspire its many visitors. Mr. Secretary, do you agree with your department's assessment that by adding President Roosevelt's D-Day prayer to the World War II memorial, that it would dilute the message of the memorial? Yes or no, because I've got a lot of other questions.
But let me just give you an answer to your question, and that is...
It's a simple question. Do you agree with your department's position as expressed by Mr. Abbey?
Congressman Johnson, we have to follow the law.
The law's been amended twice. We know what the law is. The law is what Congress gives you.
Yes, and so if you want to change the law, you can change the law as happened with Senator Dole's
practice. I don't want you to quote me the law. I want you to answer my question. Do you agree with your department's testimony that it will dilute the central message of the World War II memorial?
I agree that the law...
Yes or no, do you agree with your department's testimony that it will dilute the central message of the memorial?
I have not seen the testimony. I am certain that they are abiding by the law. And if you
no, I'm not law, interested in the law. We know what the law is because we give you the law. What I want to know is, do you agree with your department's position and the administration's position that putting on the World War II memorial Franklin Roosevelt's D-Day prayer will necessarily dilute the central message of the World War II memorial?
I have not seen the testimony, Congressman Duncan.
I'm telling you what the testimony is. Mr. Abbey's sitting right there. Mr. Abbey, can you acknowledge to the Secretary that that's what you said?
Congressman Johnson,
Mr. Secretary.
This is a matter which is within the province of the National Park Service.
Okay, you're not going to answer my question. You're going to filibuster just like you've done so many other times today, and
I'd be happy to work with you to find a congressional resolution to your issue.
What I want is an answer from you. Your department has said that putting that prayer on the memorial will necessarily dilute the central message of the memorial. Is it your position, and do you concur with that position?
Gentlemen would suspend. I know that this is important to him, and I want to know that answer also. There appears to be a conflict, but I do want to at least be respectful because the topic of this hearing was energy development and not that. But I do think, Mr. Secretary, there needs to be a response to that because there clearly is a conflict here. So I just want to bring things back. I know the passion that the gentleman from Ohio has on this, and I certainly share that passion. So, Mr. Johnson, you can proceed.
If I may, let me answer that in a more specific way than Congressman Johnson. The first thing is, in my own personal view, it does not.
Okay, that's all I need to know. Thank you.
Number two, in order to be able to move forward with what you have suggested, it would take an act of Congress to do that.
And that's what we're going to give you. That's what we're trying to give you here. So, Mr. Secretary, did you have the Solicitor's Office prepare a written opinion regarding the legality of merging the Office of Surface Mining with the Bureau of Land Management?
Yeah, I had many conversations with the solicitor, and I'm comfortable.
Have you got a written opinion from them?
what we are doing is lawful?
Have you got a written? We will determine whether it's lawful, or the courts will. I guess somebody will. I submit to you that it's not, but under SMACRA. But have you asked for and received a written opinion by the solicitor?
I've had many legal
discussions. Have you asked for and received a written opinion by the solicitor? Because the last time this subject came up of a merger, there was a written analysis which basically said you don't have the authority to merge departments like this. So have you received a written opinion?
I will tell you what my legal conclusion is.
No, I don't want your legal conclusion. I want to know if you've gotten one from the solicitor.
I have gotten legal opinions from the solicitor.
Have you got a written opinion, yes or no?
Congressman Johnson, I am absolutely
I'm not interested, sir, in your opinion right now. I'm not interested in your opinion because we already know what that is.
Well,
I'm interested
in your ear-banging, has no basis in the law.
From the solicitor, yes or no?
I am very comfortable in the legal position that we're taking.
Mr. Chairman, it's clear we're not going to get any answers here today. Maybe you can get one. Thank you. I yield back.
Time of the gentleman has expired. The chair recognizes the gentleman from Pennsylvania, Mr. Thompson.
Thank you, Chairman. Mr. Secretary, today natural gas is, I believe, somewhere $3.32 a cubic foot. It's available to citizens of this country. A few years ago, it was definitely over $12, $13 a cubic foot, not that long ago. And today, we have access to clean, reliable, affordable, American-produced energy. And as I look at what made that difference, you know, what made that possible, it really comes down to private lands and private citizens. And frankly, not public lands and government employees, I don't think it has contributed this in any way. So my question for you, first question that I have is, if the Marcellus Shale and other domestic production that provided these affordable, clean energy for our citizens were on federal lands instead of private lands, would natural gas prices be at a low of $3.32 a day?
I think it's been a combination of production from both private lands and public lands, and there is significant production of natural gas from tight sands. And as Director Abbey stated in his opening statement, 90% of the wells. The ones that have been drilled on public lands are, in fact, using hydraulic fracturing, and
I understand that, but when you look at it as the private lands today, because of what the private lands have been doing under the jurisdiction of the states have been doing safely. It transitions to my next question for Mr. Abbey. Mr. Abbey, in your verbal testimony, you talked about hydrofracking and, quote, understandably raised concerns. So just real quick, I just want to just delve into that a little bit. How many years have we been hydrofracking? Hydrofracking's been used.
Several decades.
Yeah, 60. That qualifies, mm-hmm. 60. How many wells worldwide have been hydrofracked since the advent of hydrofracking?
I don't know the answer as far as worldwide.
Let me help you. 2 million.
Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. How many wells have been hydrofracked in the United States of America out of that 2 million?
I don't know.
Let me help you there. Half of those, 1 million wells.
Thank you.
You're welcome. What is the scientific data? Let me skip one. What is the number of incidents specifically that have created problems from hydrofracking itself, the actual process of hydrofracking?
I can speak to federal wells. We are not aware of any incident as a result of hydrologic fracturing on public lands.
Okay, great. Thank you. The next one, and what is the scientific data validating this concerns that you referenced in your testimony?
It's the number of wells that are being drilled today using hydrologic fracturing.
No, but the scientific data showing, demonstrating actual incidents and problems. You said that there were zero incidents on federal lands.
Mm-hmm.
And so my last question for you with this is, coming back to your statement.
Yes.
How do you define understandably?
By listening to the public.
Okay. Oh, okay. All right. I'm not even going to go there. Let's move on to number two. I'm going to submit, Mr. Chairman, an article for the unanimous consent on shale leases in the Wayne National Forest. Recently, the United States Forest, and I know we're talking to the Interior Department, bear with me, U.S. Forest Service proposed a total ban on horizontal drilling for the George Washington National Forest in Virginia, and this article talks about shale leases in Wayne National Forest delayed for fracking study. I just want to clarify, based on our past hearings, I believe that when it's public land, subsurface, oil, gas, minerals, falls under the jurisdiction of the BLM. Is that correct?
That is correct.
On National Forest.
Yes.
So, given that clarification, given the situation with the Forest Service proposing a total ban on horizontal on public subsurface owned by the taxpayers, George Washington National Forest, and now we've got the Wayne National Forest in Ohio, which sits atop significant Marcellus Shale gas reserves, has the BLM or the Department of Interior consulted with the United States Forest Service or the Department of Agriculture on addressing the concerns of the Forest Service through regulation rather than through another moratorium on drilling on public lands, which costs jobs and government revenue? And frankly, my specific question is, hasn't this forest supervisor stepped way outside the grounds of her, his or her responsibility and jurisdiction of?
Well, I'll let the Forest Service answer that question, but let me share with you that the fact that the Bureau of Land Management serves as a cooperating agency to the analysis that's performed by the U.S. Forest Service as it relates to oil and gas drilling and leasing. It is our finding in both situations that horizontal drilling is an appropriate action on those federal minerals. We do refer back or defer back to the Surface Managing Agency to make the final determination, but our analysis indicates that horizontal drilling would be appropriate.
And I appreciate that was reaffirming actually what was shared in the
hearing.
Agriculture Subcommittee hearing.
The gentleman asked unanimous consent to insert an article in the record. Without objection, so ordered. Gentleman's time has expired. Gentleman from California, Mr. McClintock.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, you've been in office now for nearly 3 years, as has this administration. I look at the overall approach that you've taken to energy production. You've delayed the Keystone XL pipeline now indefinitely. You've imposed an economically devastated drilling moratorium in the Gulf. You've obstructed oil development in the Arctic. You've just issued a highly restrictive offshore leasing plan. You're attempting to destroy major hydroelectric dams at enormous cost. I'm just wondering, how do these actions help the U.S. economy? How do they help Americans find jobs that they so desperately need?
Well, Congressman McClintock, I would disagree with your conclusions and your assertions. The fact of the matter is that we have moved forward with a robust energy program that has a very diverse energy portfolio.
This is what you describe as a robust energy program.
We are moving forward with development.
Let me ask you this. How do these actions reduce our dependency on foreign oil?
You know, the facts, I think, speak for themselves. If one observes the truth of the facts, we are importing less oil than we were several years ago. First time in a long time that we go to an import level that's less than 50%.
Yes, but you and I both know that that's the result of a 10-year time frame that began 10 years ago, and what we are now watching is the administration systematically shutting off our future oil development by these actions. Let me go on.
I respectfully disagree.
Understand. According to Wood Mackenzie, opening up the additional areas included in the original offshore leasing plan and exempted from your announced plan could result in the addition of approximately 30 billion barrels of oil equivalent, $24 billion in government revenues per year, and 550,000 jobs for the American people. In fact, if you look at the overall of energy situation, returning to pro-development policies would produce $800 billion in government revenue, 35.4 billion barrels of oil equivalent, nearly 1.5 million U.S. jobs. What is needed to convince this administration that our people desperately need jobs, permanent tax-paying jobs?
Congressman McClintock, we are committed to job creation in this country. It is the number one issue that the President focuses on every day. We in the Department of Interior are proud of the record that we have in job creation, both with respect to oil and gas.
Well,
and
we've got 9% unemployment in the country. We began this administration with 7.8%. I'm not sure that's a record I would be proud of, with all due respect. Let me ask you one final question here. Jack Girard, president of the American Petroleum Institute, wrote to the Speaker and the Senate Majority Leader 2 days ago. In critiquing the plan you've released, he writes, potentially very large oil and natural gas resources in the Atlantic, Pacific, and Eastern Gulf of Mexico were left out of the department's plan. Comments from the department suggest this was at least in part because accurate updated estimates of the resource potential in those areas are not available. That argument, however, presents a catch-22. Information on the resource potential in these areas is old and incomplete. Yet without the possibility of a lease sale, companies will not invest in the costly exploratory work needed to get more accurate and comprehensive data. What's your response to that?
Yeah, I respect Mr. Girard very much, but he obviously is voicing the point of view of the Trade Association. The fact is we do need additional information in many places, including on the Atlantic, and we're moving forward to develop that additional information.
Well, finally, I'd just like to say that your assurances that all of these anti-energy policies present a robust energy plan for America, that you are very concerned about job creation, except when it comes to the 1.5 million jobs that we could create if you would simply get out of the way. I'm reminded of something Leo Tolstoy wrote about the Tsar's government. He said, I sit on a man's back, choking him and making him carry me. And all the while, I assure he and anyone who will listen that I am very sympathetic of his plight and I am willing to do everything I can to help, except by getting off his back. I yield back.
The gentleman yields back his time. The chair recognizes the gentleman from Colorado, Mr. Tipton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Secretary, directors. Appreciate you being here as well. Mr. Secretary, and perhaps this might apply to you as well, Director Abbey, I'd like to ask you about an issue that's important in our part of the world, in western Colorado in particular. As you know, Mr. Secretary, right now the Bureau of Land Management is in the process of taking public comment on draft resource management plan for the planning area overseen by the Colorado River Valley Office. And again, as you know, most of that planning area covers more than 500,000 acres of public lands in an energy-rich area of western Colorado. This happens to also be obviously a very economically challenged area right now. We have Grand Junction, and it was just reported in the New York Times that this regional economic hub in western Colorado leads the nation in job losses. These are tough economic times, and folks are trying to get their arms around the plan that the BLM is asking for comment on. The expiration of the comment period is, it's been a 90-day comment period. It's going to expire around the end of the holidays here, and I know the BLM frequently extends comment period when requested, and a number of stakeholders out in western Colorado in particular either have or soon will make a request that the BLM, with respect to the Colorado River Valley Plan, extend that comment period. Is this something that you would support, and if when do you think that we might be able to have a definitive answer on extending that comment period?
Director Abbey?
You know, Congressman, if you would, if you'd send me a written request, I would certainly entertain it, and the likelihood of approving that request would be granted.
Likelihood of approving it. Thank you, Director Abbey. Yes. I certainly appreciate that. I'd like to go back to a couple of questions and revisit them. Secretary Salazar, you talked in your testimony and in terms of answering a few questions about wellbore integrity and the importance of being able to protect that. You also commented that we do not have one instance of the fracking process getting into our water reserves, into the water table. Do we have any examples to where wellbore integrity has been breached when it comes to protecting water in terms of the fracking process in the United States?
There, Congressman Tipton, there are examples of wellbore integrity and contamination of wells. With respect to hydraulic fracking and the contamination of
right.
wells, there is a possibility that water could be contaminated if a well does not have wellbore integrity, and so that's why it's important that this.
We just heard, I think Congressman Thompson had just mentioned that we've had well over a million wells drilled with fracking.
In the United States.
In the United States. Have any of those shown any wellbore lacking in integrity when it comes to the fracking process?
Congressman Tipton, I think that the most important thing that we could do in a bipartisan way is to move forward in a manner that supports the natural gas industry and allows us abundantly available domestic resource to be used. And in my view, some of these issues will have to be addressed in order for us to be able to move forward with a robust natural gas domestic energy supply.
Right. I respect your statement on that, and the answer effectively was no. We haven't had any problem with the integrity when it comes to the fracking process, but and I agree with the bipartisan end of it as well, because we all want clean air, we all want clean water, and to be able to protect that as well. But all of our states have decades of experience when it comes to dealing with well construction and fracking. In fact, the Interstate Oil and Gas Compact Commissioner has a program called Stronger. Are you familiar with that? To help ensure that state regulations are up to date and that the states are fully supported in those regulatory efforts. Why do you think the Department of Interior is going to be able to do a better job than our states in terms of regulating it? A lot of us believe that you know, nobody cares more than the people at home when it comes to being able to protect those issues. We have those regulatory processes in state. Why are you pushing for the Department of Interior?
We have a responsibility, Congressman Tipton, to make sure that we are protecting the lands on behalf of the American people. And in so doing, it's important that we assure that oil and gas drilling and production is done in a safe and responsible manner.
And as it applies to fracking, apparently that job's been done.
Well, I would say that you have an open question with respect to several of these issues, and that's why we have been involved in a long process that began with a forum that I hosted at the Department of Interior to take a look at this issue. I will also say that the industry, in many ways, has decided that disclosure is also important. So part of the website and the Frack Focus program that they put together is a part of that. We've seen states from Wyoming to Texas move forward with disclosure programs. And so we have not landed yet on what kind of disclosure we might require. That's part of the ongoing process that we have under consideration.
Great. And if I could have the chairs and don't.
Time of the gentleman has expired. Gentlelady from California, Mrs. Napolitano.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I'm glad to see you, Mr. Secretary. It's been a while, and hope we haven't forgotten us in California. And
California. I don't forget Washington.
Well, I'll be calling you. One of the things that's brought to my attention is the Washington Post today indicated there was that Chevron has halted drilling off the coast of Brazil because of an underwater oil leak. The operator is Transcon, the same company was operating Deepwater Horizon rig. And what can you, do you have information on that, number one? What can you tell us about it? And if Transocean was is the one that had another oil spill offshore, resulting from worldwide drilling operations, should we be looking at another, taking another look at their operations?
Congresswoman Napolitano, I'm not familiar with this most recent story that you allude to. I will say this, that at the end of the day, we know that developing oil and gas in the oceans of the world is not a risk-free activity, and it therefore requires us, both in the executive branch as well as in Congress, to make sure that we're moving forward with safe and responsible oil and gas development. And that's why we've led the largest overhaul in the nation's programs on offshore energy development.
Thank you. It's a real serious possible way of doing business by Transocean that we should possibly continue to look at their operation. But earlier, the gentleman from Texas showed a chart that I wasn't here to see, but I understand it was shown, detailing the steps that must be taken in order to move a lease from first production and the average time of the company to bring, after being awarded a lease to the first production, shown to be 9.5 years. But the steps outlined acquire and interpret 3D and other data and find partners to share costs to drill in an exploratory well, and then contract the drill rig. Almost all of these steps are actions to be taken by the company, not the government. Is that right?
Director Boudreau.
A lot of those steps do require actions by the companies. Even seismic surveys, however, go through a permitting process that my agency and the Interior Department's involved with. But the big picture and the big answer is that we have initiated a number of pro-development initiatives to encourage early operation of these leases, early exploration, early development of the leases. That's reflected in the lease terms that we've applied and will apply in the upcoming Gulf of Mexico sales.
Thank you. And then, but in response to my question, wouldn't it be the oil companies to their benefit to speed up their completion of these steps if they wanted to begin producing more quickly?
Yes, and we're implementing policies to encourage them to do that.
Mr. Secretary, should we not be looking at incentives then to shorten these lease times and to move the production forward quickly?
Congresswoman Napolitano, the answer to that is yes, and in fact, those are some of the reforms that have been made by the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management as we move forward. It is our view that we ought not to have idle acreage that is sitting out there, and we ought to do everything we can to move forward with encouraging oil and gas production in the right places and in the right ways.
Thank you very much. I just came in late because I was at the transportation hearing on hydrofracking. And some of the questions that are being put back and forth is that EPA is being too heavy-handed in some areas and that states should have the rights to be able to implement their own standards. And my concern, and I voiced this, was that some of the pools left behind by the water that is used contains carcinogens and some other non-beneficial byproducts. And they insert it back into the earth, supposedly. They state that it does not hurt the aquifers because these are at a lower level than the underwater streams and rivers. But isn't there an issue that we should not standardize, because one size doesn't fit all, but allow EPA to work with all the states to be able to implement things that are rules that are going to protect the environment, protect the drinking water quality of folks, and still be good for business?
Real quickly, Mr. Secretary.
The answer is that we need to move forward in a way that protects the health of people and the environment, and we are doing that, and at the same time moving forward with a program that will, in fact, support natural gas development, and we support hydraulic fracking because, frankly, that is the answer to what kind of domestic production we are getting today from natural gas. And as Director Abbey testified earlier, 90% of all of our natural gas wells being drilled and producing in the federal lands are all using hydraulic fracturing.
Time the gentlelady has expired. Gentleman from Idaho, Mr. Labrador.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, thanks for being here. You've made a couple of statements today. You say we continue to produce today more than 2 years ago. The facts speak for themselves. You also said in your testimony that we've had higher production. I just want to make sure that the facts do speak for themselves. Do you agree or disagree with Congressman Flores, who said that it takes about 9.5 years to get from lease to production? Do you agree with that statement?
I agree that it takes time. I don't know the specifics of his chart, and I hadn't seen it until today, but from the point in time where the acreage is made available and going through the exploration phase, it is a multiple-year program.
And you would agree that it's more than 2 years or 3 years, correct?
From the point of making the lease sale to the point of production, yes.
Correct. Regardless of whether it's because the company delayed or because of, you know, you have all these procedures that are required by law, it's more than 2 or 3 years to get from lease to production, correct?
That is correct.
So every time I've been here, and I don't come from an oil-producing state, but every time I've been here in this Natural Resources Committee and I've had somebody from the administration come here, they're trying to take credit for the high production of oil. That just doesn't make any sense to me. If it takes more than 2 or 3 years to get from lease to production and we have the highest production right now, isn't it true? Because we want to get to the facts. Isn't it true that this is based on actions from the previous administration, not from the current administration? Is that true?
Congressman Labrador, what I would say is I love the potatoes from your state, but they're not as good as the ones from Colorado or Washington. But having said that, let me say that we have moved forward with an oil and gas production program
that's
developing oil and gas.
Yes.
Let me just give you an example to support the facts as I have stated them. There was a huge outcry from many people that we should have shut down even the production side during the national crisis of the Deepwater Horizon. We did not do that, and we have worked very hard. Some people on my staff have worked 18 hours a day, 6-7 days a week, to make sure that we had the kind of program within the Department of Interior that can allow safe oil and gas drilling and production to move forward. And we are at that stage, and the acreage that we're making available this year and next year and under the new plan will continue that program forward.
But let's just talk about the facts, because you said we want the facts. The facts are that whatever oil production we have today is because of actions that happened before this administration. Is that not true?
The facts are that it included the contributions not only of this administration under President Obama's leadership, but also President Clinton and President Bush and President Reagan and President Carter, and it goes back a long ways.
Okay. So then, if we have certain actions that happened before this administration where we were seeing the number of leases going up higher and higher and higher, wouldn't it be also true if the number of leases is going down, that we would have less oil production 5 to 10 years from now?
You know, our view is that given the price of oil over 90, almost at $100, that you are going to see a significant increase in oil and gas production. There is huge amounts of public lands in America's oceans and onshore that we've made available. Much of that will be coming into production because the greatest incentive, frankly, for oil and gas companies is the price of oil.
Okay, I'm going to change topics here. I'm a firm believer that we should shrink the size of our federal government. I think you and I agree with that, and we should consolidate programs. But my questions relate to your proposed reorganization of the Office of Surface Management and the Bureau of Land Management. I only have a minute here. Explain to me how this structure will be reorganized. Will you be creating a position that directly reports to you, the Secretary of the Interior, and adding another bureaucratic layer of reporting?
We are looking at the reorganization right now, and no decisions have been made. We need to make sure that our employees are involved, as well as stakeholders that have followed OSM. We will stay within the law of SMACRA. SMACRA requires that we have a presidentially appointed, Senate-confirmed, independent agency to carry out the duties of SMACRA. That is what OSM will do. And so Director Abbey and Director Pizarczyk are putting together a plan, and we will not have that plan until February, and I appreciate any comments that this committee may have in terms of how we look at this reorganization, because there are no final decisions that have been made.
When Director Abbey presented to some of the staff here in Congress, he talked about how one of the reasons provided for the merger was the great things about abandoned mine land reclamation that OSM could offer to BLM. Have you ever seen this document, Abandoned Mine Lands, A Decade of Progress Reclaiming Hard Rock Mines?
You know, I don't know whether I have seen that, but I have seen similar types of documents.
I ask unanimous consent for this to be included in the record. I think BLM knows quite a bit about how to handle abandoned mines, and I don't think that they need to learn anything from OSM. But I just...
Without objection, that will be a part of the record, and the time of the gentleman has expired, and the chair recognizes the gentleman from Alaska, Mr. Young.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and Mr. Secretary, welcome here. And as you see in my hat that I'm wearing, I'm supporting the Obama energy program. It's a call a propeller because there is no energy program. You're not as
guilty, though, as other agencies within this administration. I do think you've made some steps forward. But I will tell you that you're not the only player in town. You've got EPA and Lisa Jackson, an organization that's trying to subvert your authority, and they'll probably do it because they got more clout in the White House. So the energy program the Obama administration has is nothing as far as producing energy. I know you don't agree with me. But I keep saying that we've been importing, it's just not this administration, for the last 20 years, about between $300 and $400 up to $500 billion a year, we import that much oil, that money goes abroad. So every barrel of gas, every barrel of every cubic foot of natural gas and every barrel of oil makes us less dependent. And I have to say that one of the things that I never forgot, and I think you can understand this, is the gentleman said, when we turn foreign lands to supply our energy needs, then I can't help but feeling that somewhere along the way we've surrendered something of our freedom. And that was a quote by Manuel Lujan Jr., congressman on this committee and the Secretary of Interior. And that's what we've done. And I hope you understand that as a secretary of one of the largest land holdings in the world, that we need really cooperative working with states and with the industry to make sure we're not losing our freedoms overseas. That's a little speech. But having said that, though inadequate, I will take, and we appreciate your schedule, some additional oil and gas leases in the Arctic, but what steps are you taking to assure timely review and processing and permit applications, again, with the Interior and other agencies concerning the leases? And in this regard, I understand the Obama administration undertaking a permit cooperation effort concerning Alaskan energy. Where does that stand, and can you provide us with some concrete timelines?
Congressman Young, first of all, I appreciate your leadership on Alaska on so many different issues, and let me say that we are moving forward with a robust energy program that does include oil and gas and renewables and other things that very much affect your state. With respect to Alaska and the Arctic, the President has designated the Department of Interior and my Deputy Secretary, David Hayes, to ensure that there is coordination in the permitting processes with respect to Alaska.
Can you do me a favor? Again, I go back outside your agency and outside the state. When EPA or the Corps of Engineers and recently the Colville River deal, when they get involved and they stop the process which you're putting forth, let me know where I can be of help to you. Is that a good?
I appreciate that, and I will just reiterate one thing on that, Congressman Young. The position that the Deputy Secretary David J. Hayes is occupying today essentially allows Interior, through the Deputy Secretary, to bring together all those agencies so that we have an effective and efficient permitting process.
Okay, now, regarding the draft EIS and Comprehensive Conservation Plan for ANWR, why hasn't the United States Fish and Wildlife Service listed oil and gas development in the coastal plain as an alternative decision to be considered, rather just including additional wilderness designations?
You know, our position has been and is today that drilling in the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge is not appropriate.
Now, my point is, now, that's remember the No More Clause. I actually think your Fish and Wildlife Agency is stepping over their lines, and we'll eventually find out in court. The No More Clause is very clear. It's not going to go through this Congress anyway. Kid yourself, you're wasting money. But what bothers me, I understand, is certain national environmental groups have garnered 1 million signatures recommending wilderness status on the coastal plain. Most of these are communications that have a standards form, and how will the public comments be evaluated, especially since so many of them appear to be virtually identical in nature? If you follow what I'm saying, this is 1 million signatures. Are you going to listen to that, or are you going to listen to the Alaskans?
It is very important for us on our entire conservation agenda, Congressman Young, to make sure that we are listening to the local communities. And so Alaska is a world unto itself in terms of its beauty and its potential. And as you may have noted in the Wilderness and National Conservation Report that we sent to Congress, I did not include anything in there on Alaska because Alaska has its own unique set of circumstances that need to be considered.
Thank you. When I become emperor, I might consider you as Secretary of Interior, but that probably won't happen for a while. You have to understand that. What are you doing to coordinate the BLM's December 7th lease sale and NPRA with the state's onshore and offshore sale at the same time, same day? Are you working together?
Director Abbey?
We're working very close together, Congressman. In fact, I received a statement the other day from the state complimenting the actions of the Bureau of Land Management and the coordination that we're doing with them.
Good. Time the gentleman has expired.
Can I take my propeller off now? This is for the Obama energy plan. Now, I want you to know I'm supporting Mr. Markey. I want to tell you right now I'm going to
I'm sure he
the
is,
Obama energy program.
I'm sure he is thrilled with that. Mr. Secretary, I know we
I thought he was taking off his propeller because I had convinced him about the correctness of our robust energy program.
Listen, you can interpret that any way. Mr. Secretary, we had as close a hard time as 12:30, but we have Mr. Holt came in and Mr. Sutherland's been sitting very patiently. With your indulgence, those will be the last two questioners, and we should get you out of here as close to that time, if that's with if that's okay. Well, it's going to be okay because we have to do it that way. Mr. Holt's recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary. Good to see you, and it was good to see you at the in Paterson, New Jersey, at our new national park in New Jersey. Thank you for coming. Several different questions. First of all, I wanted to really look at this question of whether the energy extraction industry is our best place to look for jobs. You know, with ExxonMobil and Chevron and Shell and BP and so forth having a over the last half dozen years earning hundreds of billions, between $500 and $600 billion in profits, over that same period, their workforce shed 11,000 workers. The Bureau of Labor Statistics and the Department of Labor says, quote, employment in oil and gas extraction is expected to decline by 16% through 2018. Now, you're all on record and in practice promoting production. In fact, production is up along with these profits. But it also seems to go along with a loss of jobs. Are we looking in the wrong place, or are some people here looking in the wrong place?
Will the gentleman yield? Will the gentleman yield?
With
right here.
I would like to get an answer to the question first, and then thank you.
Thank you very much, Congressman Holt, and it was an honor to be with you in Paterson Falls, New Jersey. Let me just say that there is significant profits that are obvious to everybody that oil and gas companies are making, and the fact is that we have record prices in oil. We have major discoveries that are being made, and we also know that the future of the United States for the foreseeable future will depend on developing additional oil and gas resources, and so we are supportive of that policy. It's part of the energy portfolio that President Obama has announced in his energy blueprint.
Well, thank you. Secretary, with regard to the oil and gas leasing off of Virginia, which, of course, we in New Jersey think of as leasing off of New Jersey because it is a few days oil slick drift from our productive beaches, isn't it true that the footprint of the lease overlaps significantly, in fact, almost entirely, with critical military training areas and with shipping lanes and overflight areas?
Congressman Holt, there are critical areas within the lease sale 220 area, Virginia, the Triangle, which is something which is very important to our country, and it is a significant part of the reason why lease sale 220 was not placed on the 2012-2017 plan.
Yeah, thanks. On another matter involving the Atlantic, the legislation that was before this committee, H.R. 1231, talked about subsidizing seismic surveys in the Atlantic. Do you think it's a good idea to ask taxpayers to provide subsidies for oil companies to conduct seismic surveys?
Congressman Holt, I'm not familiar with H.R. 1231. I will say this, that we believe that developing additional information will allow us to make more informed decisions in places like the Atlantic, where we have such a dearth of information.
Let me just add my editorial comment that I wonder why in the world we should ask the most profitable companies in the history of the world to go to the taxpayers for assistance in this. We have asked, and Director Bromwich testified that he supported our idea of asking the heads of the oil companies, BP, Halliburton, Transocean, and Cameron, and so forth, to testify before this committee about the Deepwater Horizon disaster. Do you believe the CEOs from these oil companies should testify? Would that help the public get useful information about this?
You know, Congressman Holt, I don't have an opinion on that. I do believe that there have been significant investigations that have been conducted, including the most recent investigation by the joint investigative team that included the Coast Guard and the Department of Interior. And those results are comprehensive, and they tell you the sequence of what happened and the regulatory specific regulations that we believe were violated in the Macondo well blowout last year.
Time the gentleman
Thank
has
you, Mr. Secretary.
Time the gentleman has expired. The gentleman from Florida, Mr. Sutherland.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Secretary, thank you for being here, and thank you for the delay of going over a little bit. I know time's precious. I'd like to read a statement. There has been extremely negative reaction to the decision regarding Keystone in the United States. Because this pipeline and this project is obviously what's in the best interest, not just of the Canadian economy, but also the American economy. Therefore, based on the decision by this administration, Canada will seek to join the new Asian trade bloc as it tries to increase energy exports to the region following the U.S. decision to delay the approval of TransCanada Corporation's $7 billion Keystone XL pipeline. With that statement, my question to you is, how does the American worker benefit if this Canadian sands oil goes to China and other parts of Asia?
Congressman Sutherland, let me just first say that Canada is one of our best trading partners, and we have a great relationship with Canada on a variety of issues. With respect to the Keystone XL pipeline, it is a bylaw, a process which has been led by the State Department. They have listened to the input from many places, including the governor of Nebraska and Senator Johans, who have legitimate concerns about conservation.
No, I understand, but just real,
farming.
And I know time is precious for me and you. How does this decision help or harm the American worker?
But I don't think it does, because no decision has yet been made. The fact is that
the time value of money, and unlike some people that question here, you know, I come from a business background, and I understand time is money and speed is profit. So if that's the case, and business owners understand that, job creators understand that, how does this decision delay, okay, hurt profits, hurt the ability of the American worker to be able to put food on their table?
You know, I will refer the question to the State Department, because it is the department of the government that is in charge of...
But let me say this, Michelle. I've learned, and you're testifying, you're an incredibly bright man. You have an opinion. You even shared your opinion on the prayer that the other member questioned earlier. You certainly have to have an opinion, a person in your play, how this affects the American worker.
My factual conclusion, Congressman Sutherland, is that no decision has yet been made, and there are
the decision to delay.
No, there are strong arguments as to why this pipeline should go forward.
Okay.
There are legitimate concerns as to why it should not go forward, but there will be a process here, and that decision will be forthcoming.
So, is it good for the American worker that the American worker that a decision is not made farther down the road? Is it better for a worker to have a job today, or is it better for a worker to have a job maybe 2 years from now?
I think it's important to get it right.
For the person that's trying to feed his family, provide food, provide shelter, if that person does not have a job, and this person could perhaps have a job with this project, if that person doesn't have a job, is that person benefiting if we wait 2 years down the road? That's a common sense. You don't need to be a secretary of an agency to figure that one out. Do you agree with that?
I think it's important that it be the right decision,
right,
and with the right level of input and the right level of
mitigation. I'm sure the American worker really appreciates the answer to that question. And bringing that real close to home, we have in Panama City, Florida, we have Bird Pipe. And in Tallahassee, Florida, we have EXP, which is an engineering firm that has worked very hard on this project. Last week, Bird Pipe let go 100 workers in Panama City. And with this delay, there's a better than average chance that EXP will let go 100 workers. So that's over 200 in my district. And I guess what would you say to them? Because these workers are going to be are being let go as a result of this delay. What would you, if you were the one giving them the pink slip and sending them out the door, what would you say to them?
What I would say, Congressman Sutherland, is that the pipeline industry is something which is a robust industry here in this country. We have thousands and thousands of miles, including many that have traversed our public lands that we have authorized. And no one has yet made a judgment on whether or not the Keystone XL pipeline is moving forward. The fact is there are arguments on both sides, and the State Department is moving forward with a process to make sure that they get a right decision.
And I'm sure you understand why there's this massive disconnect between the 200 people that you just gave that answer to and their aggravation with inside the Beltway. Because what you just did is you just gave them a political speech, and they don't know where their next paycheck is going to come from. That falls on deaf ears. And I tell you, Director Abbey stated earlier that he listens to public sentiment to validate his decisions. If the public supports Keystone, then isn't the president's decision a total disregard to the American people and its workers? I state absolutely. And I wish the administration and the President of the United States would use your same standard of listening to the sentiment of the American worker. Obviously, they have not, and it just aggravates the fire out of me that all we've got is your statement to those 200 workers, and unfortunately, it doesn't put food on the table. Thank you. I yield back.
The time of the gentleman has expired. I have learned through the magic of instant communications, Mr. Secretary, that you are breathlessly awaiting some questioning from Mr. Bishop of Utah, so I'll recognize Mr. Bishop for 5 minutes.
That's great. I always enjoy my conversations with Congressman Bishop.
I have been
to Utah more times than I have been to Washington, I will have you know.
That's why I couch it exactly that way.
I think you were psychic in asking you to accept my question. This pains me in some way, but when somebody does something correctly, I think kudos need to be given. I have seen your wilderness proposals. I have not viewed all of them, but I have viewed the ones in Utah. I still need to talk to the people in those particular areas. But on the surface, it seems that you and Director Abbey and Juan Palma in Utah have done a proper job in trying to identify wilderness areas in my state. So I want to thank you. Don't answer because you'll screw it up. I just want to thank you.
On that note, I was going to ask the chair if he would adjourn the hearing so we could make some history here today.
However,
I knew there was a however coming.
Now turning into my Don Young mode. The Interior Department did send out a news release back a week ago talking about the amount of revenue that was coming from energy production on public lands. And you stated, or the department stated, the revenues will also support much-needed projects that create jobs, critical infrastructure improvements, and funding for education. And here is where I want to go off as a former teacher. Some of my colleagues, I understand, have already talked to you about the 77 leases, which was one of your first decisions in office. We've talked about oil shale demonstration projects that have been slow-walked by the department. The fact of the matter is, schools in the United States, 13 of the 15 slowest growth areas, states with the slowest growth in their public education funding, are found in the West, which are the so-called public land states. And it's not even close. States east of Denver have grown their education funding at a 90% plus rate. Those of us in the West, it's 40% plus rate. It's almost 2-1. Because we have the benefit of basically a land czar that deals with our particular areas. Bottom line is, unless the resources in our states are developed in the West, our kids are hurt. They are put at a decided disadvantage. You recognize this in the press release when you said this money goes to funding education. There are some actions that have decreased. That 77 leases not only destroyed an area which by redistricting I will get the chance to represent, so you'll be talking to me more, I'm afraid. but it also hurt the overall education funding of the state of Utah unnecessarily. So I want you to know that if the West is going to develop an adequate funding base for their education needs, they must have the resource development that takes place on public lands in the West. We can't have it both ways. So I'm assuming that you will support that in view of your the newsletter, and also support the Apple bill, which I have, which deals directly with the ability of helping Western states fund their education by doing those things that were promised those Western states when they actually became states in their organic enabling acts. Now, this is the one I think I can ask a direct question and answer it in very briefly. I have read in a news report that the department is planning to do restrictions on hunting opportunities on public lands, specifically Forest Service and BLM lands. Is the department currently planning or working on any types of restrictions on hunting on public lands?
Congressman Bishop, not to my knowledge, we have a program where we work with and support hunting and fishing and boating and all the uses of our public lands because of the importance of the job creation that comes, 6.5 million plus jobs just from outdoor recreation alone. Your state is, I think, Exhibit A in terms of some of those economic benefits that come. So to my knowledge, there's not that kind of policy.
Can I throw that to Director Abbey? Do you know of anything in your agency that's working on those kinds of restrictions that were in the press?
We're not working on any kind of restrictions on hunting and fishing on public lands.
I appreciate that, and I hope that if you support our energy development in the West so that we can actually fund education for kids, I have the opportunity of again thanking you and complimenting you for a correct decision.
Thank you very much.
I just noted that he yielded back his time with a compliment. That's very complimentary. Thank you. Two of them, yes. Well, that concludes our hearing. And I want to thank you, Secretary Salazar, for coming, and Director Abbey and Director Boudreau for coming. And as you can see, there are a number of different opinions here, but that's what these hearings are designed for, is to get that out and come to some conclusions. I will ask this. There were several members, just because of time constraints, that have questions. Mr. Brown had a line of questioning that I intervened with vis-a-vis the relationship between EPA and Interior. And if you could respond back with that one, I know Mr. Landry may have some further questions, Mr. Flores, Mr. Tipton, I think, referenced those. As those come into you, if you could respond in a very timely manner so that we can have that to make a part of this record, I would appreciate it. Could you do that?
We will do our very best, and I will direct Christopher Mansour, our Director of Congressional Affairs, to follow those closely and to provide the responses.
And if I run into him, I'll tell him that you said that, and so we can expect that. And finally, I ask unanimous consent to enter a copy of an August 2001 draft analysis, which includes a draft solicitor's opinion of a much smaller consolidation proposal between OSM and MMS that was referenced by Mr. Johnson in his comments to be included in the record, and without objection, that will be included with the record. Nothing to come before the committee again. The committee stands adjourned. Thank you again for being here.
Thank you.
Grace.